back to the Hearthstone World Championship. We are just three matches away from deciding the 2015 World Champion. I'm your host, Seltzer, and for those of you just joining us, we want to review the bracket really quick. Semi-final one will feature Ostkaka versus Tice, followed by Hot Form versus Kuno. The winners will meet in the finals, where one player will walk away with $100,000. We won't waste any time before getting into the matches today, so let's go ahead and kick things off. Please join me in welcoming to the stage our first semi-finalist.
Ostkaka, representing Sweden!
And now, our second semi-finalist.
Thijs, representing the Netherlands!
All right, gentlemen, join me here in the center of the stage. Now, I know both of you are players who work very hard to prepare. You study, and you crunch the numbers, and over these past 2 weeks, when you've been playing these decks, you've been getting analysis from your teammates, the casters here, your fellow players, and all you generous people online. So I want to know, taking all that into account, how well prepared do you feel you are with your current lineup of decks?
Well, first, I'm really proud that me and Ostkaka both made it to here. I think we took a cool approach by really going for the control decks, and now I also prepared for Ostkaka. I feel really prepared. I did what I called the last day to also prepare for him, and I'm gonna give my best. I'm ready.
Fantastic. How about you, Ostkaka?
Yeah, I mean, I'm really, really happy to be here, but I'm super prepared to win versus Tess.
That's what I like to hear. Gentlemen, please shake hands. And you can head into the booth. Good luck to you both. Joining us on the caster desk to bring you the action, we have Nimsh, Amaz, and Savitz, all you guys.
Thank you so much, Rachel. Hearthstone World Championships here at BlizzCon. We have four players left, and one of them is going to become the World Champion. They are guaranteed $15,000, and they have a shot for $50,000, and then for $100,000. Savitz, what does it mean to become the World Champion?
Both of the players here that are going to be playing next are professional players. This is the World Championship. This is the biggest event possible for these guys. And they're not only playing for the $100,000, they're playing for the title. And that title is going to last with them forever.
Absolutely. And the next match is going to be Tice versus Ostkaka, European's finest. Amaz, what can you tell us about them?
Well, this reminds me of when they battled against each other in the Arcanine Team League Championships, and Tice won that one. So, you know, it's up to Ostkaka to prove himself once again that, you know, he deserves to be here, and he can, you know, take him down in a one-on-one. And yeah, I think the title does mean much more than, you know, winning the prize to me, because you'd be invited to more tournaments, you know, you have a big reputation, everybody knows who you are, and, you know, really sets your mark on the globe.
Yeah, that's amazing. And guys, we actually sat with Ostkaka, so let's hear his thoughts.
When I was younger, I moved around a lot. I've lived in Miami, New York, Indonesia, and Mexico City. I think I attended like six different schools. Most of them were international, some Swedish. And it's really been quite an experience. You know, I've always had to sort of adapt to other people and their sort of lifestyle. And yeah, it's looking back on it, it's been a really good experience. So when I was playing competitive soccer, it was really more just for fun. Of course, I spent a lot of time and, you know, put a lot of effort into it. It sort of came naturally as well. Like, I mean, I was not only playing soccer like during the evening, but also like all the time during the day, on all the breaks, balancing school and soccer practice. Of course, you know, it's a lot of time you have to put into it, and you don't have a lot of time for other stuff. And so it's actually quite similar to like my Hearthstone schedule right now. I'm just, you know, trying to balance everything, you know, the practice and then actually sleeping and eating and everything, just balancing it all. Usually whenever there's a camera on me or even just a microphone, I usually get quite nervous. And, you know, as soon as like my heart rate increases, it's just not as comfortable as if I'm sitting at home playing. So I tend to rely a little bit more on instincts when I'm playing in tournaments. And it's usually not that good, but you know, so far I think I've been playing pretty on point, so I think it's fine. My youngest brother is 13 years old, his name's William. He goes to school in Sweden, he's really cool in supporting me and all this gaming stuff. And my older brother, Marcus, he lives in London, he's 22. I give my little brother some deck lists every now and then, and he asks me about the game. Of course, I'm like really willing to help him. Of course, it's fun for me as well. But it's mostly about like the time. I don't always have time for everything. At first, my parents were not like that supportive. I mean, they weren't really sure how serious it was. And of course, as I was growing up, you know, it was always your job to, you know, sort of tell me to stop playing and, you know, do my homework and whatever. But as soon as I started, you know, actually making money off of this, and I was like, really good at it, you know, they started respecting it. So my parents are actually just figuring out Twitch, and you know, it's really cool for them. It's like I'm watching TV, you know, I'm playing the World Championships, and they think it's really, really cool that I'm on this huge stage in front of so many viewers. I actually had a lot of preparation going into this event, and I always had my teammates practicing with me, you know, the whole way around. They were always, you know, questioning my deck choices and everything, and so I really had my teammates there the whole time preparing with me. If I were to give advice to an upcoming pro player, I'd say that just keep practicing, keep playing preferably the same deck, and it's like a high skill deck as well. Just keep playing it until you can sort of perfect it, and then look into playing tournaments and showing what you're worth. I really like the game. It's really like just endless amounts of skill that you can put into it, and at the same time, I'm of course really good at it, so that's really fun.
The first semifinal is about to begin, guys. Are you excited for this?
Oh yeah, this is as good as it gets. If you're a fan of competitive Hearthstone, you have two of Europe's finest going at it on the big stage. Wow, I can't wait to see how it pans out.
It's so amazing. Amaz, there is a priest being brought. How excited are you for the priest?
Yeah, obviously I'm a big fan of the priest class. And a lot of people have, you know, not been using it. They've been, you know, referring back to the standard druid, you know, the hunter, and, you know, the more stable classes. So it's always good to throw a loop in the mix, and hopefully your opponent doesn't expect it and doesn't know how to play against it. I mean, Oskaka, on the other hand, is also bringing rogue. It's not a class we've seen often in this championship at all. So both of them have their kind of niche picks, which is going to be very exciting.
Absolutely. And Savitz, as one of the most analytical players, what do you think about the lineups? Because Priest might be Tice's downfall here.
Yeah, both players definitely prepared for aggressive lineups, and that's what they came to counter. So they are playing anti-aggro matchups, but in this situation that they are matched up against each other, the difference is that Oskaka is bringing a rogue while Tice has the priest. And if those two get matched up against each other, it's definitely going to be Oskaka with the advantage because of the way that rogue has so many different tools to deal with the minions that the priest is playing early on.
All right, the players are ready to begin, so let's start the first semi-final match.
Oskaka versus Tice!
I mean, right now we see that the lineups are quite similar. I mean, they both come from European backgrounds, and I think the European meta did really just get the conclusion that they are bringing both Freeze Mage and they are both bringing the Patron Warrior. So I think it's going to be interesting.
Yeah, absolutely. Savitz, do you remember the differences in their decks? They are bringing Green Patron Warrior, but there are some differences. I believe Thais is bringing the more control one with less threats, and Oskaka has then more power in it.
Yeah, Tice's patrons seem to be a little bit more reliant on those Grim patrons and making more of those, while Oskaka's version has that Dr. Boom in it and the Chroma's Hellscream, which are additional threats, that an additional win conditions. And here in game one, it's going to be Oskaka going up against Tice's priest, and that priest has been doing well in the tournament, but Oskaka comes well prepared.
Yeah, I really wonder if Tice can win with the Priest. This is one of the most important things here in this matchup overall. If he can steal a win against any deck, he might position himself to be in a good spot. But for now, that Priest is his weak link.
Absolutely. The matchups that a Priest is good against are the aggressive decks like Zoo, Warlock, Hunter, and Tempo Mage. But Oskaka is not playing any of those. So here we go. Turn one, Zombie Chow. Definitely a great start from Tice. Oskaka doesn't have a death, doesn't have a fiery war axe just yet.
Yeah,
but he does have that death spite.
Tice actually got the dragons as well, so it's really helpful in the beginning. Maybe with Nurshark Cleric, he'll be able to draw enough cards to get the advantage. So, for the priest, the best plan is just to play the big minion any turn. On three, you want to have Black Mink Raptor, or you want to have the Cultist, and then four Twilight Guardian into. another Blackwing. So like a lot of great minions every turn to just overload your opponent. And this is also one of the strategies versus Patron, where you want to have those minions before they exploded the Patrons on turn 4 or 5.
Exactly. As a priest, you just want to curve out every turn. So every turn you want to develop something big, like you said. But Oskaka is looking at the turn 5 explosive turn with like Inner Rage plus the Whirlwind effect from the Deathbite. So that's still what Oskaka is going to set up for.
He is still missing the Inner Rage, but he's going to try to draw into it here. Battle Rage only for one card, but with two Battle Rages in his hand, it's quite valuable to just cycle, because he's unlikely to be able to use both of them as efficiently as the game progresses.
Is there any specific plan for Oskaka, or is it just going with the Patrons on turn 5 or 6 and then just pumping the frets?
Well, right now, judging by his hand, that seems to be his best strategy going forward. Maybe he'll draw into some bigger threats, such as like Dr. Broom or something, that might alter his game plan. But for now, this is his strategy. And Taish, knowing that, might not drop too many small creatures. But yeah, you see that Phelan's chosen his option right now, just to pump a minion to put more pressure on the board. The other option would be to put two small minions, but once again, two attack is not really what you want against the Patron.
Yeah.
There is another strategy for the Warrior available as well, where the Warrior just keeps clearing every single minion from the Priest and then just outvalues the Priest player with the with those Battle Rages. But as we saw, the first Battle Rage got used kind of lightly, and Oskaka seems to be aiming to do the massive Grim Patron turn.
But there are tools for the Priest to deal with those Patrons. Not now, but there should be a Light Bomb, Holy Nova as well, so there are some things to actually help with the full Patron board.
Right, exactly. Oskaka here could choose to coin up a Deathbite because he does have the Shredder at turn 4 to play. Obviously, you want to save the Death Rattle effect from the weapon when you play the Patron. So we should see just an attack here and no attack next turn.
Yep, there is the Deathbite. Thais still holding on this Northstar Cleric. He had multiple turns where he could have played it, but he understands the importance of getting those extra cards against the Patron to be able to sustain.
Alright, so again, Valence Chosen is available. He can be a bit more aggressive, but the problem is execute. If there is an execute, just attack with the weapon, and he will be able to deal with the big minion. Starting with Power Shield, trying to draw a card.
Oh, and that's a good one for the following turn. He has the option to go for the Valence Chosen here as well, but he knows that Oskaka might have an execute in his hand, so that takes a little bit of value out of the Valence. But in case there was no execute, that Zombie Chow could just win the game alone.
Yeah, and we see Taish has a lot of pressure on the board right now. Oskaka is down 16 health, but at the end of the day, it is a Zombie Chow, so Oskaka could feel a little bit safer as his life total is effectively at 21. So he has to think of an interesting player. So yeah, Shredder is a very natural follow-up if he's going to follow his strategy from last turn.
He might want to just deal with the Chow right now as well. So
true.
Maybe
Taskmaster.
Cool Taskmaster execute, it would be an option for sure.
Oh, he's going for the attack, so he might actually execute this turn.
Interesting, he chose to play the Frothing Berserker after using the weapon. It would have taken one damage more, but it would have also gained some additional attack power from the Deathbite attack.
So is he playing around Shadow War Death?
Could be, yeah. Shadow War Death sometimes can be a bit clunky for the Priest player, and if that Frothing went up to 5 power, it could have given Thais a good turn. There's the second Deathbite coming down, and Thais finds his Light Bomb. That will certainly help if Oskaka chooses to go for the Patrons next turn.
All right, so what's left for Thais? He can play Wormrest, but it doesn't look great.
Yeah, at 6 mana right now, he's really limited on the options.
Is Wormrest Agent the only play? Just Holy Nova doesn't seem great. It doesn't do anything. Yeah. The Northshire Cleric will not draw me a card.
Seems like there's no other play available. As weak as the Agent is, there's just simply nothing else to do. Definitely not the turn 6 that Thais was hoping to do.
Yeah, it doesn't look good for him. But then Oskaka is still... Oh, he got the Inner Rage. He was looking for that specifically, or maybe a Whirlwind, to just be able to play more Patrons. But on the other hand, there is that Light Bomb and Holy Nova as well.
There is that Light Bomb, but Oskaka knows that Thais is only playing one Light Bomb, so I wouldn't be surprised if he just went for it here. But there is that light bomb ready and waiting. So if he chooses to go for the Cream Patrons, maybe even with the Inner Rage and the attack from the weapon, he is going to kind of run into a lot of trouble.
What do you think, Savitz, about just playing Pilot Shredder and Taskmaster? With the Taskmaster, you maybe you just attack into the 2-4 and kill it with the Taskmaster instead of buffing your own Berserker. It will leave your Berserker on 2 health after the attack, and you can still have the Pilot Shredder on board as well.
Not bad at all. He could also choose to maybe play the Piloted Shredder, hit with the Dead Spite, draw some additional cards. But there's the Grim Patron.
Yeah, at the end of the day, Oskaga does go with the Grim Patron play, and I do like it. You only get punished by Light Bomb, and even if Taish does have the card, which we see that he does, he can't really follow up that with anything. It does cost 6 mana, it costs his entire turn, and then Oskaga can develop something behind it.
Oh, this is really good. He's not attacking with the weapon, so he's not going all in, but he still creates a board that is really hard to deal with. Because Holy Nova is not clearing this, Holy Nova will create another patron. Is Thais forced to Light Bomb?
Yeah, I think he has to. The Nova doesn't really accomplish enough. It would only leave Oskaga with 1 full health patron and a 3-1 patron. It's an option to hold under the Light Bomb. But that was such an amazing play from Oskaga, not going to commit too much into this play with the Grim Patrons for now, and he's showing it here why he made it so far in the tournament.
Yeah, exactly. He made it so that Taish has a very awkward turn right now, and if he does choose to use the Light Bomb, Oskaga actually kept this Despite as a resource to use later game, which is very important.
Certainly going to help with the Battle Rage, because it allows him to damage all of his own minions.
So for Taish, you know that there is something being planned by Oskaga. If you just go for the Light Bomb, you lose the tool. If there's another patron and something like a Whirlwind, you will not be able to deal with that board. So it seems like he's going for the Light Bomb and Zombie Chow here.
Yep, and there's the Light Bomb.
3 Light Bombs, actually.
Yeah.
The animation's pretty nice, yes.
Yep.
All right, so Zombie Chow is actually not a threat. It even might help Oskaga, because if he kills it, he can take 2 damage, and then he heals for 5. So essentially, it's more health. But on the other hand, from Tyson's perspective, you need something to create presence.
Yeah, he definitely wants to get something going. Yusera is still a little bit... he needs 9 mana for that, and next turn he will only have 8 available for him. So he's hoping to pick up something that he can play. Something that's not too reactive. Because Priest is known for playing a lot of reactive cards. While Dragon Priest is the version that has more proactive cards, there's still so many cards that might not fit the situation, and he might end up just Hero Power passing if the card from the top of his deck is a bad one.
Yeah, and also the Zombie Chow created a weird situation for Oskaga, because normally he might have just played the Pilot Shredder and maybe Slam, but right now, if Zombie Chow contests the Shredder, that's not good at all.
Yeah, I do like the Shredder play. You just have to put something on the board. The Slam already sets up for a very excellent Despite. Oskaga can choose to slam Zombie Chow and then use the Despite on something else, and therefore killing Zombie Chow as well. I guess what's going through Oskaga's mind is that Taish does run the Shrinkmeister Cabal Shadow Priest combo. And if that actually, if Taish actually used that on Oskaga's Shredder, it would be a big swing turn.
So absolutely,
that was going through his mind.
That's one of the comeback mechanisms, and it would be amazing. There is no Cabal Shadow Priest for now for Taish. He just got a second cleric. Mm-hmm. Can he even draw cards with it? Not really.
He could, but it's really awkward. You sacrifice your Zombie Chow, heal your opponent's Shredder just to draw those 2 cards. That might be what he has to do.
Oh, wow, he's actually going to go for that play. And can't. To be honest, I can't really play him for it.
Yeah, his situation right now is so just, bad.
Yeah, and those clerics might be difficult to use later on as well. Right. Oh. That's Shrinkmaster.
Shower Death. Shower Death normally is not that useful versus Patron, but versus this version, it's very useful. There is Dr. Boom, Grommash, a lot of cards that can actually get healed.
Definitely. Those were the replacements for the Warsong Commander. And Taish's Death is not a dead card. Does develop the Shrinkmeister just for a little bit more board, so that he can set up for Yzera much better.
Wow, that executes for Oskaga, absolutely a huge stroke, because that will allow him to deal with the Yzera that's bound to come down on the following turn from Taiz. Oskaga only had 1 execute remaining, and there it is.
Yeah, Yzera is the biggest threat for Taiz. This is the biggest card he has in the deck, and he certainly hopes to draw as many cards from it as possible, but with that execute, he's just going to get 1 card. And that might be a laughing system.
That's right. But right here, right now, Oskaga might get tempted to play the Grim Patron and activate his Despite right now. And that would be, not that bad. it won't, in fact, won't work on Ysera. He just needs to slap something else, but he's gonna choose to do this instead.
Yeah, Oskaka is really patient here, and he knows that with the double Northfire Cleric gun, Thais will not have that many options to draw the cards, so he can outvalue Thais in the long run. He has that Execute for Ysera, and Thais doesn't have that many cards, so if Oskaka is patient and has four patience at some point, there might not be any removal to deal with that, and he will just win.
Thais finds a Valens chosen, and with the Holy Nova, that could potentially take out the second Shredder, too.
All right, so he decides to go for the Valens Chase, Valens chosen, get that spell damage, Holy Nova as well, dealing three.
He's considering whether or not he should first attack into a Shredder before playing the Holy Nova.
Yeah, because if you attack first, the Holy Nova actually heals the Shrinkmeister up.
Yep.
And
so only 1 minute remains, and that's not good.
Totem.
That's pretty good for Thais, but Dr. Boom comes to the board here.
There is Shadow War Death, though, so even though Dr. Boom is a great card, and the bombs will have some interaction with this Flame Tongue Totem, Thais has an answer for now.
Wait, what's more interesting is if Oskaka is going to deal with this Shrinkmeister, whether he's going to use his Death Bite or is he going to use his Execute, right? If he uses Execute, this Ysera is going to be pretty steamroll, but on the other hand, if Oskaka wants to attack with his weapon, then Grim Patron suddenly looks much better.
He is going to use his Execute. So that is going to open up some possibilities for Thais with that Ysera after he has dealt with the Dr. Boom.
Yeah, that's a really strong play. Another option was maybe playing Grim Patron and then using Whirlwind, attacking into the attacking into the minion, and then using Battle Rage to just replenish your hand.
Yeah, Battle Rage was a pretty good option there, but Thais must be pretty happy knowing that both Executes are gone, but at the same time, this Flame Tongue Totem is actually contesting the Ysera. It would just die on board. So he might choose to do something else.
Well, this time, he can't really play Ysera, right, into this, so he has to go with the Shadow War Death and Dark Cultist. Dark Cultist is something that he can play this turn, so it's not bad. The problem with Ysera as well, like, if he plays Ysera next turn, he will not have any dragons for the moment. So then, if he doesn't get a dragon from Ysera's Dream card, and Ysera is being dealt with, the dragon cards that he's gonna draw, like Black Mink Raptors, will not be able to deal damage.
Yeah, that's definitely a thought that crosses Thais' mind, and he agrees with you. He's gonna save Ysera for later, remove the Dr. Broom for now, and, save that for a later turn.
Yeah, that Flame Tongue Totem, as bad as it looked when it popped out of the Shredder, is actually going to be quite valuable here with those Boom Bots.
And this is that time also that Oskaka can actually go for the Green Patron. He is going to get two patrons. He will be able to draw some cards for
those face.
Or to the face.
Yeah, it does get four, but it's not that meaningful right now, as this game has kind of developed in a way that is more about the board control than it is about bursting down your opponent.
Can Oskaka feel that this is the moment to just go all in? There's only one card for Thais. He's in a bad spot. He knows what is in his deck, more or less.
Yep, I believe. Oh, everybody is not getting in here just yet.
Oh, no, I think he's actually going to
He is going to go for it.
Yeah, just to maximize damage. Boomba hits for three, and then the Death Rattle hits the face for a couple more damage.
I like how he played Lothar first, so that he can get a bigger Battle Rage next turn.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And Thais is looking at 15 damage right now on the board. He knows that if there's even one more point of damage available for Oskaka next turn, playing the Ysera here would cost him the game. But on the other hand, Twilight Veil, that's not going to win you the game.
Yeah,
while Ysera might.
Twilight Veil is actually really bad here because the patron will, propagate itself.
There is a Drake, but Oskaka has so many draws to get to lethal. Whirlwinds.
Oh, not quite.
Not yet. But he can damage one on patron and draw one more card with that.
I think drawing four cards right now is a pretty good
I think four is going to be enough. He's looking for another weapon or an Inner Rage, Cruel Taskmaster, something like that, to find that one extra damage.
Even Grommash, like if he decides to not use Whirlwind and then use the Battle Rage, if he gets Grommash, that will be enough.
Whoa, he decides to cycle the Whirlwind as well.
Just one more chance to get the weapon that he's looking for.
See if he finds it.
Alright.
Alright, Armorsmith is not the card. Not quite, not really. Inner Rage!
That is going to do it.
Wow, there's an rage for Skaka. This means he has
none. Wait, the flame tongue told him to shift the positions.
What?
It's actually not lethal anymore.
It's not lethal because of the new patron that spawned next to the flame tongue totem.
So Oscar should have attacked the five attack patron before doing that play, and now he's actually gonna, you know, miss lethal. It might not be too punishing as Taish can't really deal with this board, but that was an interesting, you know, mechanic there.
But I'm sure it's really stressful for Skaka at this point.
Yeah, I mean, how often does that situation pop up?
Well, not often, and certainly not often at the World Championships.
Exactly.
Okay, guys, so Tyson's one more draw, and that's couple Shadow Priest. He can steal the Flame Pump Totem!
That's true, but it's not going to help him, and Tyson's going to drop a game with the Priest, Skaka showing us why Patron War is still very relevant.
Yeah, absolutely. So, Skaka thinks game number one versus Tyson. This is the first loss for the Dragon Priest, which is a weak link, we can have to remind you. Tyson really needs to win with it at some point. But on the other hand, guys, I'm thinking about Skaka. Like, what is going through his mind? You know, he knows that he misplayed.
Right.
With that attack, not attacking. And then, like, the fact he's really composed, will stress him more, or will he be all right after this, Savitz?
I think he will be just fine. Ostkaka is an experienced player, and that was such a rare situation. We didn't spot that flame dunk interaction. I don't think many viewers at home either, like, noticed that would happen, and he would miss those two damage points. He has a 1-0 lead. That must give him confidence going forward.
Absolutely. He played amazingly, and all the things he did, not attacking with the Death Spite, not creating too many patrons before the Light Bomb, forcing Tyus to use his removal cards as early as possible. So, a really, really great play.
Yeah, exactly. Like you said, you know, just focus on the good moves that you did. Don't worry about the careless misplay. It didn't really affect the game at all, right? At the end of the day, you're the one with the 1-0 lead, so, you know, you got the edge.
So, Amaz, how awesome is it to see the Dragon Priest on the big stage?
Yeah, it's awesome. Of course, Tyus feels like it's a very strong deck, according to his meta, because you don't play a deck for fun in a competitive tournament, right? But, you know, I think it's a very good choice. The Shrinkmaster Cabal Shadow Priest combo is a one that not a lot of people remember sometimes, and it can swing the game around. So I'm really happy that Priest has, you know, shown his face in the East World Championship.
Yeah, up to this point, it has really shown its power, and Tyus has been doing well with it. I think it's also worth pointing out that what Tyus does not have in his lineup is the Druid. Tyus is famous for his Druid play. He's an excellent Druid player. We had 13 Druid players.
Out of 16.
And Tyus was not one of them.
Mm-hmm.
That was really surprising.
Very surprising
at least
to me, yeah, too.
Yeah, he is known as the best, well, not maybe not the best Druid, but one of the best Druids for sure, and it's his favorite class. He didn't even play it before. He just found Druid to be the most fun class for him personally.
Yeah, in a meta filled with Druids, it means 13 out of 16 Druids, right? You want to play something that can counter it. And I think Dragon Priest actually does that pretty well. Druids, you know, ramp up the first few turns, and then the Priest just drops these one drops, these strong two drops. Like, you know, minions that have bigger stat lines than what they're supposedly costed for. So I think it's a very good meta call.
Absolutely. And Savitz, what do you think Skaka is going to bring next? He's locked with his Patron. Patron 1, he will not bring it again because we're playing Conquest Best of 5. What is the next class he can bring here?
I think Ostkaka might just roll a dice here and go for either one. He can't really know for sure what Tyus is going to bring, and so many decks remaining, all different decks, obviously, different matchups. It's hard to tell, but I'm going to predict Rogue, but that's just a guess.
That's a very good guess, but let's actually hear Ostkaka talking about his decks himself.
Preparing for a tournament, it's very much based around like how many players there are. You know, if it's a very small amount of players, then you can be more specific and try and predict exactly what everyone's going to bring. But if it's like a 50-man tournament or something like that, then it's very much important to just bring solid decks and not try and be too specific. So for this tournament, I brought Oil Rogue, Remade, and Patron Warrior. And the goal of the decks is to try and beat decks like Paladin and Zoo with all three of my decks. So for now, I'm actually really comfortable with what I brought, and I'm really happy. And I think I did my preparation really well.
We've traversed the tombs of Naxxramas. We've climbed every cliff on Black Rock. Now the world cries out for heroes. As a new evil rises, there will be danger. There will be doom. There will be ancient temples filled with relics, treasures, and traps. Who will answer the call?
We will be explorers lead, and we are in need of explorers. Adventure we seek, cross land and sea.
All right, guys, we're almost ready for game number two, but League of Explorers seems really cool.
Yeah, it does. The quest for the golden monkey, or the origination rod, more like.
Yeah.
That's going to be cool, but right now the players are playing for the trophy.
Absolutely. The trophy looks amazing. Mm-hmm. And Savit, do you like Oskaka's lineup overall? Freeze Mage. It's so cool to see Freeze Mage on the big stage.
Absolutely. Freeze Mage has a lot of good matchups. One of the bad matchups used to be the Warrior, just because of the hero power and the ability to go above 30 health. But Oskaka has made the call here that the Warriors are going to be less than with what we saw before the Warsong changed. So I like bringing the Rogue a lot. I think it's a little bit of a gamble. Doesn't have a good matchup against something like a Face Hunter, but it has been paying off for him in this tournament.
Well, Oskaka is really confident in his lineup, and he said that he's not only favored against Tice, he feels like he's also favored versus other opponents if he wins versus Tice here.
Yeah, I mean, both of these players are actually very similar in their mindset of, you know, anti-aggro. So it's interesting when they match up together, right? They're playing pretty much the same decks, except for one deck difference. And, you know, the matchups are going to be pretty weird, because how often do you play, you know, a Freeze Mage Mirror? It's a little bit more special, but here we're going to see Oskaka is going to play Rogue, like you predicted, Savish.
Yep.
Against the Freeze Mage. So how do you think about this matchup?
It can go either way, but I would give the edge to the Freeze Mage, because Freeze Mage has so many tools to deal with the minions from Rogue side with the AoE spells. Mm-hmm. And Rogue has to use those minions to deal enough damage and through double ice barriers and the anti-kill, but it might be difficult.
So what's the best case for Rogue? So if Freeze Mage has a good matchup, Freeze Mage just needs to do what Freeze Mage does. Just set up the defenses, then draw the cards, get to the combo, and stop the Rogue from dealing damage. What is the key thing for Rogue? Is there like a big flurry?
Well, yeah, there are a couple of options. You could actually pressure them a lot with your early game minions, getting those repetitive damage before things like Blizzard and Flamestrike stop the board. And of course, if that strategy doesn't work, you always have the trump card, which is Lotheb, which just stops every card in the Freeze Mage deck. And, you know, hopefully win the game after that.
Yeah, I think the most successful strategy in general for the Rogue player is to put as much pressure as possible early on. Because if it goes to very late game, the Mage is going to be the one with the advantage. So Rogue player has to end the game before Alexstrasza, before the one turn kill after it.
So that said, Savitz, what do you think about Oskaka's hand?
Well, it certainly is an interesting one. Those backsteps, not so valuable. He does have a Violet Teacher, which is definitely a good card. Sprint, if he picks up a preparation, and there it is going to be also very strong. That preparation is going to help him get those extra minions that he needs.
Does need another spell to combo the preparation with, but on the other hand, Tice has a, you know, pretty solid hand. The Hoarder can cycle for more cards, especially what you want in the Freeze Mage. Not the best turn three can establish a secret, but so far looking like a standard Freeze Mage opener.
All right, but it's not like the best Freeze Mage opener. He doesn't have the Mad Scientist. He maybe would like to have Acolyte of Pain to just play the
game. Yeah, it's not the best, but it's reasonable. And Oskaka here, realizing that, you know, it is a race for damage, did use his dagger last turn and this turn, and it's going to reward him since, you know, he has to use his hero part this turn.
Another ice block, a little bit rough here. Tice was definitely hoping to draw either Acolyte of Pain or Arcane Intellect to get through his deck faster. Now also, the Mad Scientist later on might be a bit clunky in case he draws another barrier to his hand.
Well, exactly. Mad Scientist could only proc an ice barrier now since both ice blocks are in the hand. So if Oskaka knows that for a fact, then he can actually, you know, do some interesting plays around it.
Oh wow, Edwin. Edwin is one of those cards that can be set up pretty early. If Oskaka is able to cast a lot of spells, the big Edwin can be troublesome.
And this is not the hand to do it with, though. He would really love to have something like Deadly Poison, Eviscerate, maybe a minion from Thais's side to be able to use the backstab to get even a bigger Van Cleef. Here, we're likely to see a 4-drop. Might be either the Violet Teacher or a Pilot Shredder. You could also go for preparation sprint, but turn 4 pilot is radar. I don't know if there's anything better than that, really.
Yeah, at the end of the day, you do need to establish a minion, get in that repetitive damage against Freeze Mage. You don't really need card draw right now. The damage is much more important.
Oh, there is the Mad Scientist before he got all the secrets, so maybe he'll be able to play it now.
Yeah, definitely a good draw. And at 4 mana, he can also ping or Frostbolt the Pilot Shredder.
I kind of like pinging, I think. Just set it up, but he decides to Frostbolt to deal with it immediately.
Oh.
Yep, and there is the Mad Scientist.
How important is anti-kill button in this match?
Oh!
Is it the time for Vancleave?
Oh, it might be.
Yeah, that's it's interesting. You can just preparation into something that you don't really need it for. You just want the extra buff.
Do you double backstab?
Backstab your
wow,
master
swordsman. We know that putting a big minion against freeze mages is really strong because usually they don't have much removal. Their only removal is through damage. So that's why, for example, handlocks, when they play like a mountain giant against them, it's really, really effective. So Skuka's gonna mimic that with the Edwin, but not this turn. This turn is just going to establish some minions, like some 1-1s.
Getting that big Vancleave would have required using the preparation, and keeping the preparation for the sprint is going to allow him to play the sprint and minions on the same turn later on.
Yeah, it's absolutely essential for him. He needs to pressure Freeze Mage as much as possible to put Tice in those awkward spots where he either has the removal or he takes the damage. But there is a nice barrier from that Mad Scientist, so that's 8 points of health easily gained. Oh wow, another Mad Scientist.
Well, it's not too bad, I guess. He can play it right now, and that will thin his deck a little bit more, and he will find the cards that he needs even more instead of drawing into any more secrets after this.
So what does he need right now? Is he looking for a Doomsayer, a possible Blizzard, Flamestrike, some AoE clears?
Yeah, I think card draw is the most important thing. The hand, as it is right now, just doesn't seem to be doing enough. So those cards that you mentioned, like Blizzard, Flamestrike, Doomsayer, the board clears. Yes, he does need those cards, but he needs something more. So he needs to first find the card draw for it to increase his hand size.
I also like that Taish also used his hero power instead of used Frost Nova. Because Frost Nova effectively only gains the amount of health your opponent has in attack, right? So Frost Nova would just heal for 7, where later on, it might be even better. Or you can even combo with stuff like Doomsayer, so I like keeping it.
Absolutely. Haskaka going with the sprint, 4 extra cards, and
finds another preparation. I believe the next turn we might see a huge Edwin Vancleave.
That could be possible, but
it's reasonable because on some spots, Mage just has to cast this big removal. And if you have that Edwin set up, it's not dying to it. You can't conceal it, but it's really hard. And even if you have to spend a fireball, it might be bigger than the fireball.
Exactly.
There actually isn't that much big removal in a Freeze Mage deck. Some players do deck in maybe a big Game Hunter. We don't really see a Polymorph.
Oh, that was a long time ago when that happened.
Yeah, but Skaga is still far away from winning this game. There's a lot of health for Tice, so he will have enough time to draw some extra cards for sure.
I think it's actually a little bit problematic for Skaga that he has so many minions on the board right now. That might prevent him from playing the Vancleave, because playing the spells before it is going to fill the board.
Yeah, that's very true. So if Tice does choose to, for example, Frost Nova the board, Skaga can actually, combo spells beforehand for the Edwin Vancleave. So,
But do you really Frost Nova this board? I think there is not that.
No, he's almost at 40 health here, and after the ping, there's only going to be 7 power from the minions. I think he's fine, just like hero power passing.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, kill the 2-1.
Ice Lance from the top was not the card that I wanted to see.
Yeah,
this absolutely
is exactly
worthless right now.
Exactly what you mentioned, Stavitz. He's missing to draw. Without the draw, he will not be able to get all the answers he needs. And one of the big strengths of Freeze Mage is that is going to draw almost the whole full deck, responding to what your opponent is doing.
He's going to go for the fireball on the teacher, but that is going to allow Ostkaka to play that big Vancleave if he chooses to do so.
Well, there's double Frost Nova for Tice, so Vancleave might get frozen for a couple more turns, but
how many can he play? The Poison Flurry, Preparation, Blood Mage, so the Vancleave could potentially be a 10-10 if he wants it to be.
Yeah, 3-mana 10-10 is a pretty good deal.
Sounds good to me.
Is it the best play, though? Tice, even though he doesn't have War Clears, he has those freezes. He has 3 of them.
I think it's almost impossible to say no to it. He also has that sap available for later on if he... Oh.
Whoa. That's interesting.
Pay attention, class.
Okay, so going with the teacher, stronger minion than the Blood Mage would have been. Still gets to play the Van Cleef, saving the Flurry. It would have been a 10-10 the other way around, but this allows getting the teacher on the board and saving the Flurry later on.
Yeah, Tyson also used the Fireball on the Violet Teacher, which pretty much means that he doesn't have a Flame Strike in his hand, right? So it feels very comfortable establishing another one since the last one was so hard to deal with.
Absolutely. Oskaku got so much information with the Fireball last turn.
Yep.
So what do you do here as Dice? You got Antonidas, so another kind of dead card. Unless it will allow him to have another strategy. If he actually waits till turn 9, he'll be able to coin the Frost Nova as well with Antonidas.
Whoop. Seems like he's just going to slam the Antonidas now. Cash in two spells for two fireballs, and make it a very hard time for Oskaku to deal with this minion.
Yep, but Ostgaka does have the answers. Even has that play in Flurry.
Well, so the Antonidas play is forcing Ostgaka to do something with it, kill it or maybe sap it, and it also gave ties to Fireball. So his hand didn't look that great, but now if he changed the coin into the Fireball and also the Iceness that wasn't doing much. Mm-hmm. So he has some ways to fight back. He recognizes his situation is not great.
Yeah, Taiju's hand just doesn't have enough cycle that a freeze mage usually wants. So he just has to make the best situation out of, you know, a poor hand. Oskaku, on the other hand, is going to try and...
He's going to clear. That looks like we are going to see the Blade Flurry for 6 damage here. Both eliminating the Antonidas from the board and dealing a decent amount of damage to his opponent, Zero.
Yeah, absolutely. And he also keeps Eviscerate for some extra burst for the future.
We do see that Oskaku is kind of all in here. He's playing all his hand and only has a Sap and Eviscerate left for some amount of burst. Taish really needs to find a Doomsayer, but that's not the card he was looking for.
He gets the card drawn out, but is it too late?
Yeah.
He wants a Doomsayer.
Absolutely. With that Doomsayer, he could have had Doomsayer Nova, and then even after he gets sapped, play another Blade again and another Nova. Right now, he might have to go for the Acolyte to try find those extra answers that he needs.
Mm-hmm. Is this the moment that you Nova anyway? You obviously ping Acolyte to draw a card.
He has to Nova, otherwise the Ice Block is getting popped. Cone of Cold, no, it's not too bad.
Yeah, it's actually all right, but then look at Oskaka's positioning, having Edwin and the big minions are on the other side of the board.
Yeah, that's perfect positioning.
Yeah, Blizzard would have been certainly a better card. Really smart positioning, like you mentioned here. Having that Erwin Van Cleef on the side and the other big minions on the other side.
Yeah, even though it looks really bad for Tice, as long as he draws his Alistraza in time, it might be very hard for Oskaku to seal the game. Tice already has 12 damage in his hand. He still has, you know, a Frostbolt, and he has the second Ice Block as well. So if he can stagger his turns correctly, Oskaku can't actually come back from this. So he's going to actually sap the Acolyte, prevent Tyus from drawing more cards since, you know, he feared the inevitable might be coming soon.
Yeah, absolutely.
The sap not too strong here, but he didn't really have any other plays to make. So it was either that or nothing.
So amazing. Like, if he gets like, oh, Flame Strike.
Flame Strike from the top with the ping that would only leave up the
Edwin
Van Cleef, and that is going to be an excellent position for Thais if he chooses to go with the Flame Strike here.
Alexstrasza was a bit better, because with Alexstrasza, as Amaz mentioned, just get him to 15, and then you have double Fireball, and you have ways to deal, even to pink him to death.
That's right. It was really interesting that the Master Swordsmith buffed the Edwin.
Yeah,
that so that, you know, it's that much closer to popping Thais' Ice Block.
The only minion that would survive the Flame Strike ping.
Right.
Getting the buff here. Tyson is thinking about all of his options. There could be some different lines of play with potentially some of their freeze spells.
Yeah, potentially.
If he freezes right side of the board.
He could, and also being the 3-1 maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, he could also use Frost Nova and the Anti-Killbot, such that the Anti-Killbot attacking the Edwin would, clear it next turn with the Flame Strike paint, but he's actually going to spend a Fireball.
Yeah, he's going to set up the Flame Strike for next turn.
Oh, very cool.
Yeah, that's a really nice play. Oskaku will not be able to play any minions here.
And one of the win conditions against Rogue is clearing their minions. And oh no, no space! For the low fab.
He could eviscerate.
But oh. I mean, how do you make that play? How are you going to make that play?
That would be an insane play.
My mind would be blown if he actually went for it.
And he's going for it.
Eviscerating his own blood mage stunless.
Wow.
To get that load, he knows there's a flame strike coming on the following turn. He's
That's very heads up because Taish doesn't have the Frost Nova. Usually Frost Nova is the counter to Lothab. It costs 8 mana, you can still play it. But now Taish just can't do that. And look at the cornucopia positioning. The biggest three minions are separate on the first, fourth, and seventh position. That's just amazing.
That's so amazing, yeah. On the other hand, he also knew that Violet Tisha is not gonna create the minion to have the space for Lothab. So what can Taish do?
What does he do here if he dies?
This is
I guess the Cone of Cold.
I guess, but where do you go?
Yeah, where do you put it, you know?
Is the icebox still getting popped?
This really changed the game. Taish was in a really good position there with those minions frozen.
It's so awkward, too, because Cone of Cold costs 9 mana. Usually you can ping and play the Cone of Cold to kind of shift the positions a bit, but...
You can't even kill Edwin here.
Yeah.
he can't stop the ice block from getting popped here. With the Cone of Cold, even on the biggest minions, he could stop 11 damage by using it on the Van Cleef side of the board. But there will still be 14 from the other minions in combination with the weapon from Ostgaga. So Taish knows that the ice block is getting popped anyway if he just used the Cone of Cold. So it seems like he's going to hold on to it for now.
All right, so he's going for anti-heal bots.
Still going to set up for the flame strike.
And how much damage is there incoming?
That's a lot of damage. We see, let's see.
10, 16, 18, plus 6,
so
24.
24 on the board, 25 including the dagger. So yeah, Ostgaga could choose to clear the board. But of course, the Acolyte Pain, you want to just deal 3 damage to it, remove it off the board, and not draw any additional cards.
I'm a tiny bit surprised that Taish chose to go with the Healbot here, because with that Flame Strike and second Ice Block on the following turn, he could have the Healbot could have maybe potentially be even more valuable after the second Ice Block. Because he kind of needs the Alexstrasza to be able to hang in there.
That's true.
But can he win with Alexstrasza? Right now this Ice Block is getting popped, so he will need to play Ice Block next turn not to die.
Yeah, well, his strategy is going to revolve around clearing the board next turn of Flame Strike and setting up Ice Block, and then drawing the Alexstrasza to heal himself. He already went to the route of clearing all of Ostgaga's minions and winning that way by Fatigue. So the game plan changes a little bit here.
Yeah, it's a good strategy, but Ostgaga is the one who was able to cast Sprint and get even more cards. Mm-hmm. So we tried to set up the kill with the dagger. Is Alexstrasza the only out not to die?
It would have seemed so. Wow, sapping an Acolyte as well just to prevent additional cards from place.
Yep. Decides that he does not need the sap anymore for anything else. Denying that card draw. He knows that that Acolyte would have not only drawn one card, but at least two, maybe even three.
Both players are so calm. Just look at their faces. They're calculating, thinking about everything. They're here at the world stage of Hearthstone.
Yeah. Maybe they're kind of stressed out inside, but you're just not showing it, you know?
Yeah. And here is the Flame Strike, finally. That Lothab delayed it a tiny bit. Taish does get to play it here, but one Ice Block is popped, and the second one is just about to get the same treatment.
Yep. Now, Ostgaga's, double oil is going to be really, really good. So even if Taish does choose to play Alexstrasza next turn, healing himself back to 15, Double Oil should be able to clear the game.
Yeah, and there is no more Ice Block for Taish, no more Ice Barriers. All the secrets are out. Everything is plain inside.
Yep, and because Ostgaga knows that Alexstrasza is the only way that Taish can stay in the game, he feels comfortable in healing himself.
There is still a chance with the Ice Lance in combination with the Alexstrasza in case that the oils would land on the right minions, but Blizzard not going
Blizzard
to
not
do
the
it.
Card, and Ostgaga having the SI7 agent can actually deal the remaining damage after the board gets frozen.
Even the Flurry can also deal that one damage that's remaining.
Yep, Taish needs to fish for a card right now. He's in a very desperate situation here.
Absolutely.
Alright, so he's fire blasting the minion to see what he can get.
There is no card that Taish can draw here. And goes for the Cone of Cold Ice Lance. If you're looking from his point of view, there is still that tiny chance, but Taish knows with 6 cards in Ostgaga's hand, that it's highly likely that there is going to be a card that...
Flurry's gonna do it!
Yeah, and Ostgaga's taking game number 2 over Taish.
Very impressive.
Yeah,
very, very impressive.
That eviscerate play from Ostkaka on his own Blood Mage Stunless. I think that one won him the game.
Yeah, absolutely. And you said it's a bad matchup, and it seemed like Thijs had that moment where he could maybe come back. Even though he didn't have the great hand, he had a good position at some point, but eviscerate into Lothab.
I mean, it's not only that. He played the Lothab in the middle of his whole minion board and made the corner code so awkward for Thijs. That was just amazing play.
You think he played the Blood Mage in the middle before that, so if he needs to eviscerate later on, he can play the Lothab in the middle?
That's in depth, it's possible.
Yeah. Okay, all right.
That was really next level. The positioning, the damage counting, everything. He was able to sap the important acolytes as well before. He put Thijs in a very awkward spot and just grabbed the win.
Yeah, and now, speaking of awkward spots, Thijs needs to win 3 games against Ostkaka's Freeze Mage, and that is going to be very difficult. Thijs does have the Warrior, which is a good matchup, but he has the Priest, and Freeze Mage is so good against Priest. They don't put nearly enough pressure, and they have all the time in the world.
And there's also the Freeze Mage mirror match, which is kind of a coin flip, but then the more experienced player can actually win.
Yeah, sometimes it comes down to the draws, but also the more experienced player can take the advantage in games where the draws are fairly similar. Both of these players, however, are excellent Freeze Mage players, and I don't think there's a massive skill difference there. Both of them are so good and play fairly flawless.
All right. Shout out to the fans that are watching the audience right now. You guys' signs are awesome. And we'll have to see if Ostkaka does take it to the grand finals. It's going to be amazing, but only one European can advance, right?
They are Europeans' finest, the best players we have, Savitz. And one of them will have a chance to become the world champion. But before we even conclude this match, before we even go to the next game, we have an interview with Thijs for you guys.
I think my past really made who I am now. I look everything positive, even if something is really negative happening in my life or happening with me, it's something I learned from, so it's not bad at all. It feels sometimes like the day back where I played in the King of the Hill and I had a chance there to make a name of myself, and surprisingly also for myself is that I did really well there and I won 9 times in a row. And after that it went just really fast. I had an invite for DreamHack and I get picked up by a team, and I'm still super surprised how fast all the time go and that I'm now just here being a competitive Hearthstone player. When I was younger, I was kind of ill. I was really struggling with myself, really anxious, and I had some more mental problems, and it took that time, but how I'm getting out of it, like, it really improves your personality, and now I'm just, I feel really strong. I was really unsure about myself. I was always thinking how others will think of me, how they will like me, so that was somewhat of a problem for me. But after that, I just realized that if I'm just myself, that's the best way to go. And if people don't like it, then it sucks for them. The gaming was a good outlet for me. When I started gaming, I always played already some games, but I enjoyed myself. I found my way making things easier. I felt really comfortable where I struggled sometimes with being comfortable, communicating. Now it made me easier. The motivation of me is, it's something that was always already with me in every game I played, even if it was just football or just a small game with friends or not even a game. I just always look for perfection, and something that also, when I play Hearthstone, I play it for fun, but I always want to be one of the better, or I want to improve. And it's just how my personality is somehow. But now with the there's also a lot of motivation. I just like Hearthstone a lot, the game. And I'm just enjoying everything I do, and that is the biggest motivation for me now. I think in most of the regions, in Hearthstone at least, it's pretty friendly how people look at it. Of course, you are competitively when you play the game, but after the game, you can have some frustrations, but you will still be friends. I'm not going here to survive the groups. I really want to win the tournament, and that's why I'm just taking a lot of risk. And I'm pretty sure people didn't expect this lineup from me. For me, winning BlizzCon will mean a lot. Just being the world champion is something I could not even dream of.
Thijs had such a long journey. I still remember Thijs when he was starting. He was just winning some online tournaments, then he entered the King of the Hill, and he had so many wins in a row, and suddenly he wins DreamHack, second DreamHack he is in the final, and then he is the European champion, and now he's here on this amazing stage with amazing audience watching him perform.
Yeah, I mean, he's on a hot streak lately, but you know, he's in danger right now of getting Oskaga stopping his hot streak. So he has to keep that positive energy like he talked about and just focus on his plays, focus on the game, and just win three games.
He's practicing so much. Saviz, what are his chances to still win this match?
Well, I gotta be honest, it's going to be extremely difficult. The Warrior is likely to get a win, and I would expect him to play it first, just to get a little bit of extra confidence. You don't want to get 3-0'd ever, and you even more don't want to get 3-0'd on the World Championship stage. So that one is likely that he is going to be able to take down, but it's only going to get more and more difficult in the series if he can go forward.
Even if the matchups are difficult, I believe in Thijs. I think like mentally he is able to come back. This is Conquest format, and I've seen reverse sweeps before. And Thijs was also one of the players. I've seen him losing 0-3 and then winning the series 4-3. So he's one of those guys who really thinks methodically about the games, and he will not break here at the world stage.
Yeah, Thijs has been down 0-2 in many tournaments before. He's an experienced player, and I'm sure he can still do it. There's still hope for him, and he's going to just play one game at a time, and maybe it'll work out.
All right, so he picks up that Warrior. Amas, what do you think about the matchup? Saviz mentioned it's pretty good. Why is it so good?
Yeah, it's really good because Freeze Mage's strategy revolves around playing Alistraza and then burning you down from 15 health. But the mechanic of armor from the Warrior just, you know, throws that out the window. When your opponent uses Alistraza on you, you have 15 health, but say you have like even 10 armor, and the Mage does not have enough burn, they just fizzle out and you win that way. And that's really the main strategy that Warriors tend to go with. Armorsmith helps with that a lot, and of course, Execute is a key card in removing Antonitis, in removing Emperor Thorazon, and even Alistraza. They just have all the tools to deal with this matchup.
All right, so it seems really good, actually. And Oskaga bringing the Freeze Mage. Saviz, this is a bad matchup for him. Is there any valid strategy that he can use?
Absolutely. You want to, if you're the Freeze Mage player, you have to get the Archmage Antonitis, because Freeze Mage without the Antonitis has very limited amount of burn damage. So with those extra fireballs, he needs to get as many of those as possible. And if he does get it with an Emperor effect first, then Archmage Antonitis, maybe one mana Frostbolt, zero mana Ice Lance, that kind of combo is going. There's definitely hope for him.
There is one more strategy that Oskaga can use. And that strategy is to fatigue the Warrior. Because a Warrior has a limited number of threats. This version that Thijs brought is a very anti-aggro one. So he is not running Dr. Boom. He is bringing only Grommash, I believe. Okay. And he doesn't even have Pilot or Shredders. This means that if Oskaga survives and prolongs the game long enough, he might actually be able to fatigue the Warrior. At some point, Thijs will just not have any threats.
Yeah, that's definitely a valid strategy. It might be a bit more tricky since you do not have healing while the Warrior's hero part is effectively healing. So it's a little bit more tricky. It really depends on if Warriors use their card draws or not. But right now, Oskaga is going to pull out Secret from the Mad Scientist, and it's actually super helpful because he doesn't need to draw it later on. So he can draw something more valuable.
Yeah, but I think it's unlikely that the Oskaga would go for the fatigue game plan unless he sees Thijs make a big Battle Rage early on. And Thijs is an experienced player, and if he notices that Oskaga is going for that type of strategy, Thijs will stop drawing and maybe not even use the Battle Rages at all.
Yeah, that's absolutely a fair point. And looking at their hands, what do you think about Oskaga's hand, Saviz? He's got those two secrets.
I gotta say, it's not that great. He needs that extra card draw. He needs to find the Arcane Intellect and the Acolyte as soon as possible, fill his hand, find the Emperor, find the Antonitis. A lot of things have to go right for him.
And it's a bit awkward because if he goes for the fatigue strategy, he doesn't want to draw the main cards.
Yep. Yeah, exactly. So that's why mages usually want the Archmage Antonitis. And then, you know, it's theoretically infinite damage with fireballs. You just need to make sure that the Warrior cannot kill your Antonitis on the turn it's dropped. Thijs, of course, is looking to hero power every turn. That's a very good strategy. And save the Armorsmith for when you have a lot of minions and you can have a Whirlwind effect, perhaps, and just get even more armor that way.
Maybe even get double the Armorsmith for
exactly
more effects, yeah.
Does go for the shield block here. Wants to get that little bit of extra armor right now and the additional card.
Yeah, more options is always a good choice against a mage. And Freeze mages naturally draw themselves, right? Mad Scientist actually draws a card and puts it on the battlefield. Loot Hoarder draws a card. So yeah, it's really tough for warriors to out-fatigue.
Loot Hoarder, not a bad draw from Ostgaka there, but it doesn't increase the size of his hand.
Nope, it's another cycle card. So yeah, Oscar's still looking for something better. Taish, on the other hand, does have the Patron. It's not too effective against Freeze Mage. They do have Flame Strike. They do have the Thalnos Blizzard. But, you know, it's one way to actually just pressure the Freeze Mage enough to win the game. But the more reliable one, based on what all the pros say, is to just gain so much armor that Freeze Mages just fizzle out with not enough damage.
Well, so Patron can help you with that. Instead of playing it really early to pressure, you can maybe save it for later to play it with both armor smiths.
That's true.
Yep, sometimes you can go really quickly with the Patrons and try to get it on turn 5, make a big one before the Flame Strike comes. But in this situation, it was a little bit late. He didn't have that extra whirlwind effect set up just yet. So even if he was to go for the 4 Grim Patrons next turn with the weapon and the Inner Rage, it would be likely to get wiped out with that with that Flame Strike. And Ostgaka, Arcane Intellect, not just one, but he picks up 2 Arcane Intellects, and those are exactly the cards that he was hoping to see.
Yep, and now if he actually finds an Emperor, perhaps, and the Antoness in hand, he can create a lot of fireballs.
Yeah, absolutely. Just drawing the cards is his way for now. Biggest thing, that the lack of Thorison for the Warrior changes anything in the matchup?
Not really.
Not really, yeah.
He doesn't need it right now. It wouldn't help him all that much to decrease the cost of those cards that he has in his hand. It's not that much about the mana costs for now. It's an unstable ghoul. I'd like you to just see a hero power pass here. Maybe the ghoul, because why not? But
sure,
doesn't really accomplish all that much. But he also doesn't need to hold on to it for later on.
But this means that Tyus is not pressuring much. He's just armoring up, which is a great strategy, but on the other hand, the game might go long and long.
Yeah. I mean, it is the more consistent strategy, right? Patient Warrior against Freeze Mage, outlast your opponent, and, you know, win the game by that way. Ostgaka is the one that's kind of being pressured to pull enough damage before the end of the game happens. So, double armor smith is pretty decent.
Double armor smith is amazing. If he finds another whirlwind effect, he can potentially gain a lot of armor on one turn by playing both of the armor smiths at the same time and using those whirlwind effects to get that extra armor and get out of burn range from the Freeze Mage.
So what's the best way to deal with this?
Archmage Antonidas. That is a good card. He definitely needs that, even though it's not the time for it just yet, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Ostgaka does need to cycle more cards, but it's a really awkward hand right now, right? You want to play the Arcane Intellect, but you are sitting on 10 cards, so you need to play something, but you don't want to play anything. It's an awkward position.
You can Blizzard, I believe.
You could really
just
want Blizzard?
Throw it away.
Yeah.
You only throw away one card, though, so... It's just an awkward turn.
I think Ostgaka still has time. Like, if he just throws away some cards here...
Oh, really? That's surprising to me. I was expecting him to save that Icelands.
Yeah.
Play it in combination with that Archmage Antonidas. Seems like he has a different game plan. I'm really interested to see what Ostgaka is planning to do. And, How does he feel like he doesn't need the Icelands?
Right. Icelands is usually the spell that you can combo with Antonidas to get more fireballs. But Ostgaka feels like that perhaps this might be the turn Tyus wants to use his Deathbite.
No.
But then once again, Tyus can just sit there, hero power, you know, chill out a little bit, and it's Ostgaka once again was pressured to actually do something.
Well, you're mentioning chilling out, but how stressful and how straining mentally this match is.
I mean, it's for everything right now, right? It's a single elimination. If you lose the series, you're out of the running for BlizzCon World Championships, being so close to the trophy. So yeah, I'm assuming the pressure must be super high.
And you also can't be active. It's more about being passive, thinking about your plays, and this is one of the slowest matchups at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, one little mistake might change the whole thing, and that's just what Hearthstone is. So you have to remain focused. Even though some turns you think it's kind of, he's just going to hero power pass, you know, it's kind of negligible. It's very important to always consider your options.
Absolutely. Savitz, are you considering options for Ostgaka now?
Yeah, I'm trying to see how could he manage with this hand. His hand is
full right now. It's so difficult. He has ways to draw more cards. He has the Acolyte. He could even use the Ghoul to kind of draw him a card, but the full hand is a huge problem. He needs to get rid of some of his cards before being able to draw more.
How do you like the preemptive from Sayer here?
I mean, he just wants to throw it away, basically. It doesn't accomplish much, but it's like, why not?
Well, basically, the Doomsayer is not as good as a card, a random card from his deck right now, so he just feels like he just doesn't want to use it. Tice here can just, once again, just sit there and hero power, gain some effective health, and just play a card that he doesn't really need. For example, like the coin. Yeah, doesn't feel too important right now.
Ostkaka not the only player who's struggling with the hand size right now. Tice also with 10 cards, and he needs to figure out what card he wants to throw away in this situation, because he doesn't want to burn the next draw.
That's so interesting, because the Doomsayer would normally be executed, but the fact that Ostkaka just threw it away will mean that no execute targets. So executes are going to sit there in Tice's hand, forcing him to do some actions to make the plays.
Right. Looks like he is deciding to go with the coin in this situation. Thinks that everything else in his hand is more valuable. I wouldn't say that the slam is more valuable. That doesn't solve the problem, because it would only...
It would only cycle
for another one. Right. So.
And also, decrease his chances of the fatigue race.
Yep. Oh, Alex Straza
from the top.
So, Alex Straza deals 13 damage. It's not going to deal any more damage throughout this game. And it's a play that you don't feel too bad playing about. Once again, Tyson's strategy is to reduce you down to fatigue and then, you know, just fizzle you out with armor. So I don't think there is a situation where you need to Alex Straza yourself.
I'm trying to think if there's any reason not to play the Alex Straza. And Ostkaka also thinks it's the best play in this situation, and he does put it down. And this is likely to be the double armor smith turn from Tice, and he's going to get a lot of armor.
Yeah, with the patron, with the Deathbite, Death Rattle, with the inner rage, this armor is going to soar up really, really high.
Yeah, even though he got that damage from Alex Straza, it's one of the winning strategies. Such a small armor smith, but he's getting an advantage.
How much is it going to be? He's at 11 right now, so he's going to...
That's plus 2 of the inner rage.
The double world is one from the dead spot.
No, you do need to use the execute.
That is true.
Yeah, so you do not get the whirlwind, but you still have a board of armor swiss. So
yeah, that's shouldn't be unhappy about that.
Yeah.
Plus 8.
Yep, and with that board, when Ostkaka chooses to AoE down the board, he is going to get another round of armor.
Oh man, that's 12 armor since there are 6 minions on the board.
Yeah, so the best way to deal with that board is having a Doomsayer.
Doomsayer, yes.
Right? Salnos Blizzard is also a... Oh, or Flame Strike. There you go.
But again, that is going to give Ostkaka... that is going to give Tice 12 armor if he goes with that Flame Strike right now, and it would...
That's right, Savitz, but on the other
very
hand,
high in the HP.
On the other hand, Tice is stuck with a lot of useless cards in his hand.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. And what else can he do?
There's a lot of interesting concepts that arise from the situation right now, right? Because Ostkaka, using the Flame Strike, you know, is going to stabilize him, but then, you know, he might not have enough time to kill Tice, right? He's going to count in his hand that, yes, Tice did use one execute. So if I play another threat, my second threat will be bigger. So for example, Emperor and Antonidas, those are usually the big threats, right? And another thing you realize is that Ostkaka did use his Arcane Intellect very early on, and that was actually really good because it's going to get him closer to fatigue. So all these little things start to come up right now.
Yeah. And it seems like Ostkaka is actually going for the fatigue plan.
Yeah, with 49 health, I'd say that's what he's doing.
Well, he needs Antonidas. But fatigue damage will be helpful.
Right.
Yep, and Doomsayer, well, that's a little bit late for the party.
Not the worst right now. I mean,
not the worst, but last turn it would have been so good. Potentially denying that, either denying the armor or baiting out the execute, so the Antonidas would have had a better chance to survive.
Yeah, you do want the execute to be used on the Doomsayer, but Ostkaka feels like he wants to use these Antonidas right now. Hopefully, the execute isn't in Tyson's hand so that this Antonidas goes in a rapid round of fireballs. But unfortunately, that's not the case.
Well, it seems like Ostkaka can play risky a bit. He is still in a great spot. He has 3 chances with the freeze mage. So here, if he risks that there is no way to activate the execute, or maybe if there is no execute, he might just win the game right there. But we obviously know there is a way.
Mm-hmm. Yep, he can choose anything he likes here. He could go with the Fiery War Axe to damage the minion before execute. He could also go for the slam if he's not too worried about drawing the card here. Does get him closer to fatigue, but it's not really a huge issue for now.
Well, I mean, it might come back to haunt him, right? Every card draw is kind of scary. You take that one fatigue damage, you don't think it's a problem, but if you draw two cards before your opponent, you're taking 10 fatigue damage when they're taking only 8, for example.
Yeah.
It does rack up really fast.
That is true, but he also has a lot of HP right now. He has 49 effectively, and he's going to get another 2 here. So if it goes to the fatigue, it might be, it will still be ties with the advantage unless he goes into the fatigue, a lot of cards before Oskaka.
And also Oskaka is running out of threats. With this Antonidas down, he has only Torison as a big minion.
Wow, yeah, and because Tice just realized that there is one more big threat, he's gonna opt to save the execute along with the Whirlwind to clear it off.
Yeah, that's pretty smart.
And I want to point out that he did choose to use the second slam last to kill off the minion from his opponent in order to prevent himself from drawing that one extra card.
Exactly. Card draw is sometimes, you know, a double-edged sword in this matchup.
This matchup is so delicate. Every card draw matters. And those Acolytes of Bane, if he follows up on it, they're dead cards.
Yeah.
You can't play them anymore.
Yeah, you definitely don't want to play them. They draw 3 cards because it's going to ping them, right?
Yeah.
And you do not want to draw 3 cards right now.
That's viable. Well, yeah, Oskaka doesn't really have much to play here.
Mm-mm. How much burst is left for Oskaka?
Well, not 48, that's for sure.
Not 48, so...
He will need fatigue to finish the game.
That's true, yeah.
Absolutely.
So this Arcane Intellect is probably not going to get played ever. His Acolyte is also not going to be played. It's going to be interesting.
Rosna Vadim Sayer. Does he even need Vadim Sayer here?
Just gonna stall up for, you know, maybe person Emperor. Yep. Taiji's mind is a bit ticking. It's like, okay, maybe he has another AoE that he's saving for later. So maybe I want to keep the frothing, you know, to be used after this Dread Corsair dies. I think Taiji's position is very interesting in that he only needs one minion to have enough pressure. This 3-2 represents a lot of damage.
Yeah, surprisingly so. Keeping that frothing, no real reason to play it here. Oh, explosive ship. Well,
is that a threat?
Not a threat.
It's a card you can throw away and deal with a 3-2.
That's true. It's an alright trade, I suppose.
Alright, we have some deck cards left. We have 7 cards left for the Freeze Mage player, Oskaka. And Tice does have 8 cards left. So yeah, once again, Freeze Mage is ahead on cards.
Yeah, even in the cards remaining, Tice is doing better than Oskaka right now.
I was really conservative with the drawing. Never play those Acolytes. Use that slam to finish off.
All right.
This is going to be almost impossible for Oskaka to close out.
Exactly. When you're behind on fatigue and your opponent is ahead on health, it seems like a double whammy.
Well, he does have some burst.
Yeah, but once again, burst is not enough. Fatigue damage reacts just so quickly. Mm. Like, right now, Oskaka has 2 cards ahead, right? So he'll be taking, 2 extra fatigue damage cards before Taiji does. And what that means is that 8 fatigue damage, you're taking 19 more damage than your opponent, drawing the 9 and a 10 before your opponent does.
Maybe let's count how much damage he has left in his deck. So he should have 1 more fireball because it's 1, which means this is 12, 18, and he'll have double frostbolt and 1 more ice lance.
Well, okay, so. Kromash as well. That's even worse. But yeah, if you count all the damage, you have to deal at least as much damage as you have right now, right? So Taiji needs to be reduced down to 26, and I don't think Oskaka even has enough damage to reduce Taiji down to 26.
There's no way. If I was Oskaka, I would start thinking about the next game already.
Yeah.
He might be like planning his next pick.
Sure.
What to play.
Because the thing
is, he's going to stick with the mage, actually.
Yeah, exactly. But Oskaka can even play the Thalnos, because Thalnos draws a card. Like, there's just so many dead cards in his hand.
Maybe if he uses Thalnos at the absolute end game, when he uses it to like, just bump the damage.
If there wasn't so much on the line right now, I believe we would just see that concede from Oskaka. But when you're playing for this much, you kind of want to play it out, even if you know that it's very unlikely that you're going to win in the end.
Certainly. Yeah.
Super unlikely. Taij has a battle, an inner rage on the Grommash. That's 12 less health from Oskaka, but there is an Ice Bear, so 4 less health. But that's still, you know, still damage.
Yeah, and weapons as well. So Fireworks is 3 damage. That's why this is supposedly plus 8 mm-hmm. in the course of a couple of turns.
Well, Mad Scientist is not gonna do much. All of his secrets are either played or in his hand right now.
But it's a minion, you can deal damage with it, that's important.
That is.
It does deal that two trades with the Wider Warax charge.
Every point of damage matters. Skaga can deal 1 damage every turn, Thais can heal 2 damage every turn.
On the flip side, every card draw minion doesn't matter. And it actually matters more that you do not play them at all.
And Thais is playing a lot of cards on his deck, he still has the battle rage in every. 1 more Numbish Inventor?
Yeah, possibly. Just things that you don't want to play ever.
This game is so
interesting. Emperor finally comes into the hand of Oskaka. A little bit, bad. What was that called? He drew his Emperor. He drew his Antonitis before his Emperor, so the ordering was a little bit unfortunate.
Definitely. One of the most important things in this matchup, plus the Freeze Mage, is to draw that Emperor early on and. It might be a little bit late for the party in this case.
It's still a 5-5 minion, something that Thais will have to deal with.
That's true.
They execute.
Yeah. Thais is already counting the number of threats, because Freeze Mage only runs the 3 threats, right? Thorazon, Antonitis, Alexstrasza. Once you remove those, it's all about the health game.
He might be also counting the number of turns with Fatigue. How does it look like? because at this point, Thais knows exactly how much health Oskaka has with the heal bot and with the ice barrier.
Right, but still, it seems only a moment ago that Thais had 39 health, but now it's like 49 health, and it's only going to increase.
And Thais played so much Warrior in the past. I've seen him in the Fatigue matches many times before, so he has the experience. He's not being flustered by it.
Okay.
Another Whirlwind.
Alright, activator for execute, I guess.
Sure.
Yep.
He doesn't want to take that 5 damage to his own face here. And with those 2 whirlwinds, he might as well just use one here. Also, the execute, there's nothing else to execute later on, so the Emperor will go down.
Seems about right. Since both the armistices are gone already, whirlwinds have no more value other than deal 1 damage.
Dice should have 1 rotation as well.
Okay. But that really doesn't matter. I mean, Taij just needs to clear all of Oskaka's minions from this point out. Keep on using the hero power because it's twice as strong as your opponent's hero power right now. So that's his game plan.
All right, so for Oskaka, he can't use much burst, I believe. Maybe you want to keep Thalnos, Fireball, Frostbolt, Ice Lance for the last moment.
Yeah, even so, the... best combo you can do with Thalnos is 21 damage. Well, that's before the Emperor, but even with the Emperor, Oskaka already used one of its Ice Lances already, so...
But he needs to play a card, and you don't get the full value from Healbot. Doomsayer, you might need it if there is a board. Mm-hmm. So he's going to throw away the Fireball.
Fireball into a ping. Getting Thais down to
43 health, oh no! There you go. Like they said, the other Battle Rage comes in hand, so... Yeah, it's really just the formalities right now.
Armor up and pass.
I mean, I'm pretty sure that Taij is not going to mistake here. He's a very experienced warrior, like you said, and he realizes that his win condition is just the hero power pass.
Yep, the game is getting closer and closer to the end. Oskaka almost out of cards.
It's so interesting that they are just locked in this eternal struggle. Mage versus Warrior, just waiting till the final condition comes to play. Which is
you could see this kind of like as a, concession break when you're watching like a concert or something. You know, this is like, oh, break time, guys. You know, like you can kind of chill out, run this match through and then, focus on the other matches that are going to be much more important. Freeze Mage Mirror is going to be very
well. On the other hand, Amaz, you blink, you miss one thing, and maybe you will miss who wins this.
Oh, okay.
So you want it? It is really intense for those players.
It does take a lot from not Oskaka to if Oskaka wins this game. It's because Taij also helped Oskaka win this game, and now that's not going to happen.
I'm actually a tiny bit surprised that we haven't seen that. Concede from Oskaka. I'm not sure what exactly is going in his head right now. Maybe he's trying to think about the other matchups. Maybe, like, how to beat this, how to beat Thais' other decks with his Freeze Mage.
So one of the reasons might be that he wants to fatigue Thais.
But
like,
I mean,
mentally, like mentally, not okay. The game.
That could be the case. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
Well, at the end of the day, it is for, you know, $250,000, right? You might as well just, you know, give the option for your opponent to make a mistake.
Yeah.
Because why not?
Absolutely. And Tyus is in a bad spot overall in his matchup. He needs to win versus the freeze mage 3 times. Even though he has a good situation right now, just concentrating, counting damage, it takes a toll. Oskaka at this point might be like, it doesn't matter, I lost this, I know it. Mm-hmm. But I would just play cards and pretend I still have a chance. And Tyus will think, do I really win this?
Yeah, right now Tyus does seem like he's in a mental zone right now. Just goes with his stick of his guts here.
And fatigue hits a bit.
Yep.
Got out of cards. That was the fireball, the last card. So how much damage is available for him? There is an
ice. Not 45.
Yeah, that's not 45.
Yeah.
But it's some. All right. Ice is 5. Frostbolt is 4. It's 9 plus 7. It's 16. Amazmav, correct?
My math says it's not 45.
That's pretty true.
Yep.
Tyus here thinking whether or not to attack with that dead spy. Those Gnomish Inventors and Acolytes of Dead completely useless in his hand right now.
Well, the answer is why not, because you do know that Oskar played an Ice Bear already. He doesn't even have a second one.
Yep, that is true.
Perfectly fine.
Alright, that's Kaka taking first fatigue damage.
Yep, from now on out, the ice blocks from Oskar completely worthless. Those do not work against the fatigue, because fatigue damage is taken in the beginning of the turn and secrets only trigger on your opponent's turn. Mm-hmm.
Unless you actually play a heal bot and then fatigue will not kill you. There is like an instance so that your opponent will not be able to proc ice block.
Well, that's Malorn I'm thinking. Malorn means that you never fatigue, but
yeah.
All right. Let's realize go. It. So,
Dice takes game number 3.
There you go. Gets on the board.
Yeah, finds his first win in this series and he is not out yet. He needs to win 2 more times against the Freeze Mage. Might be more difficult with the other decks, but he has a fighting chance.
So yeah. We assume that the Priest matchup is really bad for Tyus and Freeze Mage will have a great advantage. What about the other mirror? Are there any differences you guys recall?
Yeah, the mirror is all about like knowing if you know how to play the matchup at all. You know, things like Ice Barrier is very tricky because if your opponent plays a secret and you activate the Ice Barrier, you're effectively giving them a lot of health. And Freeze Mage doesn't play a lot of minions, so you don't want to trigger your opponent's secret unless you're very greedy, for example. And of course, Alexstrasza is one of those swing cards. Not only can you use it on your opponent and set up for a kill, you can also use it on yourself after your opponent expends all their spells and then they fizzle out. So it's a very intricate matchup.
Savitz, are we going to see any Frostbolts into Mad Scientist, into Ice Block?
Most likely not, but it might happen. Who knows?
All right. So what are you guys most excited about?
Well, the small decisions, because the next matchup is most likely going to be that Freeze Mage Mirror, because that is the better deck out of the two that Tyus has remaining. So I would expect him to save the Priest for last. So it's the small decisions, the early turns. What do you do? How do you ping? And what do you save for later on? What cards do you feel like you can use to deal with early minions, for example?
All right, before we jump into another game, we have a small video prepared for you guys.
If you want to be a competitive Hearthstone player, you just really have to look at yourself. And with yourself, it's not only your Hearthstone gameplay, but also just look where you are and look what will be the best for you. People always ask me, should I bring these classes? But start with the classes you're comfortable with. Start with the classes you know the best. It doesn't help to go to the best deck in the meta and not playing them well. As for tips, start with online tournaments. Tournament meta is way different than ladder. Also, never copy tournament decks on ladder. It's a horrible experience. People always copy my decks and then they see double BGHs or 6-1 drops in Priest. And it just doesn't work. So I will just trust in yourself and make the best out of that. I still remember the first time I went to Sweden and my parents were super scared with what I was doing. And I was actually a bit scared too because it was my first time and didn't really know what to expect. it doesn't really matter how it goes for me. What matters for my parents, for my friends, for my brothers is just that I enjoy what I'm doing. And in this moment, I'm really enjoying everything I am doing in Hearthstone.
Oh man, cosplay is real. It's really important to enjoy what we are doing. And we see Elkie and his wife enjoying the cosplay as well.
Wow, that is amazing.
Dude, those cosplays are actually pretty legit.
Yeah, absolutely. Can you name those characters, Amaz?
Yeah, I'm Mal'Ganis and Valyra.
Yeah?
Yeah, they're really well done. I'm really impressed.
Absolutely. Mal'Ganis is his favorite card. Mm. And even though we've seen Elkie play yesterday, and unfortunately for him, he lost, he is able to be here as Mal'Ganis today.
Yeah, it's pretty scary though. What if somebody is cosplaying Big Game Hunter?
Oh.
Yeah, you're right, Savitz.
You don't want to meet that guy.
Yeah, absolutely. You need to avoid him. Well, Mal'Ganis is eternal.
Okay.
But till Big Game Hunter shows up.
Almost eternal.
This is real life, Savitz. It's not Hearthstone. You know, Big Game Hunters, you know, just Mal'Ganis just stomps him away.
So you just high-five Mal'Ganis if you're a Big Game Hunter?
Oh yeah, you can go that direction too.
Perfect. All right, guys. Oskaka is leading 2-1 versus Thais. And Thais has a really difficult matchup in his Priest. And Mage versus Mage Mirror is really intricate as we talked about it. Mm-hmm. Guys, I have a different question for you. How creative do you have to be as a pro player to be at this stage at BlizzCon, the World Championship, with your deck choices and deck building?
Well, the thing is, like, you're kind of balancing consistency versus the surprise factor, right? And the thing with this format is that sometimes when you bring a surprise deck, it comes back to haunt you because you do need to get a win at least with each of your decks. So in that case, some players do prefer the consistency, but Thais, on the other hand, thinks that his Priest is enough to, you know, be big enough of a surprise factor that players might not play optimal against it and just, you know, get him the win there.
Well, the Priest got him so far, but right now we're going to see the Freeze Mage versus Freeze Mage matchup.
Well, Ostkaka's hand is looking amazing right now. He has the Mad Scientist and double Arcane Index, but Thais also with a decent hand. He has an Acolyte of Pain and Arcane Intellect. Also yeah. The Blood Mage. Well, not a key card in this matchup. Just throwing it out early to get the cycle.
Yeah, it's funny that you mentioned that because you kind of skipped over the Blizzard, Frost Nova, and that's exactly what you don't want in this matchup because, you know, as a Freeze Mage, you don't play a lot of minions. You don't really need those board clears. So what you're really looking for are those cycle cards, the burn cards, and the big threats.
Yeah, there are a lot of worthless cards in this matchup, and most of those AoE spells.
Speak to me.
But also, the Doomsayers might be tricky to use.
Mm-hmm. Well, it seems that Thais's hand is improving a bit with the Arcane Intellect and the second Mad Scientist. So, it's not over yet, for sure. And Oskaka got a lot of burst instead.
Yep.
Yeah, but the Arcane Intellects are just so key in this matchup. You do want to cycle for more cards. Because you either spend your turn cycling or spend your turn using cards that don't really matter in this matchup. For example, losing that Blizzard when you have 10 cards.
Yeah, the Arcane Intellect here seems fairly obvious. There might be some other plays, but it's hard to argue against that.
Is there any merit thinking about fatiguing your opponent?
Not this early on, at least.
Yeah, that's not the game plan usually for a Freeze Mage Mirror. It's usually you have enough burst to kill them after the Electros on themselves and after two ice blocks, or, you know, defending yourself after the two ice blocks and after your opponent uses Electros. So it's kind of like a, you know, bluffing kind of game.
So you don't want to give them more cards because then they have more options and they will faster get the ice blocks and
Electros. Sure, yeah. So fatigue doesn't really, you know, settle in until later.
All right.
Right. Explosive Sheep might be a decent play here. It's hard to get a lot of value from it. He doesn't have to do it if he doesn't want to. Also, Mad Scientist and Ping would be quite good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's actually
taking out the Acolyte of Pain with that already on the board, Scientist.
It's actually a very big board, right?
It is a huge board. It's 4 attack because Alexstrasza does reduce your opponent down to 15 health. So effectively, you are starting the match with 15 health only. If you can use your minions to deal that 15 damage, you can actually just save the Alexstrasza to use it on yourself, and you don't need to use it on your opponent.
Interesting. He chooses to go with the Doomsayer. Figures that Doomsayer probably not very important for later on, so might as well play it here.
Well, that and, of course, the board is really, really threatening right now with 2 attack.
Oh,
every
absolutely.
Damage matters in this mirror.
What is the situation of the Ice Barriers? Because sometimes you may never proc the barriers. If one mage has the barriers and ice block, you just Alex Strasser them, and then you use your spells to pop the block, and then they get the block, you pop it again, and then you win without ever proccing the ice barriers.
Yeah, I wouldn't imagine that Thais would attack here. It was a random seek. There's 50-50 chance that it would be a barrier, and in that case, instead of dealing 2 damage, you would heal your opponent for 6.
Yeah.
Yeah, that risk versus reward doesn't seem quite right.
Yeah, it doesn't seem worth it.
Now, Skaka decides to draw with the Arcane Intellect, getting some cards, Thalnos and Ice Barrier. Trying to pressure a bit with Mad Scientist.
Yeah, still no Emperor Thorisson from either side. It's one of the better cards in this matchup.
Mm-hmm. It's really good because not only does it reduce your cards, it also basically says you gotta remove me right now, and usually the best answer is a fireball. And when you lose a fireball to an Emperor Thorisson, well, your opponent might be able to, you know, piece out some strategy to avoid, you know, more damage. They might burn you a turn earlier. Mind if I roll
knee? Absolutely.
And there's Loot Horror into Frost Nova with the second Frost Nova in his hand. There's not much reason to hold on to it. Probably just a good thing that he gets rid of it. Freezing the Mad Scientist. Not all that meaningful in this situation.
Well, for now, Skaka has that Alexstrasza in hand and some burst. It's not enough burst to win after Alexstrasza is being played. But it is important that he has those cards, and Thais doesn't have the heal. So in case that Thais doesn't pick up a heal at all, then Skaka might put Thais to 1 health and then just win with the pings.
Yeah, that's right. Pinging is one of the main things to proc the ice block with. So once again, the anti-heal bots are very, very important in this matchup.
Yep, while that ice barrier looks like it could be playable this turn, he won't be. It's unlikely that he would actually do it, because then this mad scientist on the board would not find anything. And he's going to go with the ship, killing off his own scientist to get the ice barrier up right now, making his future draws better, because he does not want to draw into the ice barrier from the top of his deck.
All right, so both secrets are up for Skaka, for Thais. He needs to make a move here. Antonidas is not good.
One power on the board, but yeah. That is.
Do you flame strike it?
Oh, absolutely. You cannot get rid of that.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, flame strike is not that bad.
Yeah.
I mean,
throw it away.
Exactly. Yeah, what are you going to use flame strike against? I think the best target for flame strike in this matchup is probably the anti kill bot. So in that case, you know, just, you know, you lose it. You can lizard and cure power anyways. Yeah.
He absolutely could go for the flame strike here. Just to make room for those extra fireballs later on. And he's going
Scarred
to do
for it.
Yeah. 11 for overkill, but no overkill.
Oh, man.
That Thalnos was too much of a threat.
Right. And now we see Skaka actually in a pretty good position. The coin does matter a lot in this matchup. I mean, you can Alexstrasza one turn earlier. You can always turn it into a fireball with Antonidas. Just good to start second.
Actually, because he has Antonidas for the next turn, he will be able to turn both Ice Lances into Fireballs and Coin into Fireballs. So he's essentially getting 3 Fireballs.
Exactly. So it seems like this play will be just a Blizzard nothing. you know, trumping Taish's Flame Strike against one minion is a Blizzard or nothing.
And he's going to go for it. The Antonidas Coin Ice Lance would be an option for Ostgaga's turn 8, but also the Coin Alexstrasza are quite powerful.
Yeah, that's absolutely really strong. But then if you get the Antonidas on the board and get those fireballs, your opponent has to deal with the Antonidas.
Oh, a preemptive Doomsayer from Thais. He knows that there is the coin still in Ostgaga's hand, so it's one of the better ways to get a preemptively deal with it. In case that he doesn't go for that...
Wow! This is so good. He might still go for the Antonidas and fireballs here, because after that he can just smash Thorisson and he would have so many cheap fireballs.
Oh wow, really? I mean, if he Emperors this turn, next turn his Antonidas costs 6, his fireballs cost 3, Ice Lance are cheap, you have like limited fireballs pretty much.
Yeah.
So yeah, Emperor has to come down here.
Yeah, you can't say no to an Emperor like this. There's so much value in it right now.
Oh no.
He's going to go down to the Doomsayer, but he's still in excellent shape.
Thais does not look happy about that, because Doomsayer, it was supposed to stop your opponent from playing their entire turn, but Ostgaga still managed to find play.
And Thais, he knows he is with his back to the wall. He needs to win this matchup, and this is the best chance for him, because the Priest is the tough one. If he doesn't win him, he's eliminated.
Oh yeah, I mean, either or, he has to win this game to stay in alive, right? So this is a very tricky situation.
So you know, Torison had a lot of cards, and you know the cards were good enough so that the Skaka actually decided to play that Torison. Mm-hmm. What do you do?
Well, right now it seems that Oskaka is the aggressor. He's going to probably Alexstrasza or like burn Antonitis with you with a lot of fireballs. So what we're trying to find is a more defensive approach. You know, find a second ice block, and then after both of your ice blocks are popped, anti-Killbot, Alexstrasza, and fizzle out the mage that way.
Actually, he doesn't even have the first ice block here, because the secret is ice dance.
Right.
The ice block.
Yeah. Oh, seems like he's gonna do a preemptive Antonitis before Oskaka uses his minion, just to stop Oskaka from developing things for one turn.
Yep, going aggressive here. It wasn't quite optimal, but out of the options that he had, it kind of seemed like the only play he can make. Mm-hmm. And Oskaka here with a lot of options.
If he goes for Alexstrasza and just limits the health to 15, he will have enough to just kill Thais.
Well, yeah, but the thing is, like...
It might be an ice block.
Yeah. The threat of ice block is too high, and the threat of Antonitis sticking on the board is also very, very high. We do know both players play anti-Killbot, so...
Well, we just need to calculate the damage, right? If you feel like opponent will have a way to deal with your ice block next turn, then you absolutely kill Antonitis.
Right, but yeah, you just kill Antonitis. It's too risky not to.
Fireball, Ice Lance deals with that, but he doesn't get the damage to his opponent's face.
Yep, doesn't really matter though. He cycles three of these cards for fireballs. I'm pretty sure the coin is going to change into fireball. Oh no, he's actually going to keep the coin.
Yeah, with that coin here, he could potentially cast three fireballs on the same turn because one of the fireballs is discounted to three mana cost.
Absolutely.
Very cool.
So Thais needs to deal with the Antonitis. It's not difficult. He can just fireball and ping it. But what else he can do? He's still searching for the icebox. He's searching for his own Alexstrasza.
Yep.
It does have to deal with the Antonitis like Oskaka did. But not as clean as Oskaka, since he did establish a minion afterwards.
Fireball ping seems like the only way to deal with that for now. He could go for Arcane Intellect first to see if he can pick up something else. No, Arcane Intellect is not playable right now because he does have 10 cards in his hand.
Is there any merit in another preemptive Doomsayer? Because you are expecting that Alexstrasza will come at some point. But you've seen Torius and Antonitis already.
Yeah, but I mean, how often is Doomsayer going to be used? Oh, we're just slinging the fireball right to Oskaka's face here.
Yep, Oskaka with the decision here. Does he want to go aggressive with that Alexstrasza? He could also maybe save it for later on if he needs to use it on himself. Mm-hmm. But at 16 HP and no Emperor played from Thais' side, he might feel safe.
Yeah, Alexstrasza seems really good here. On the other hand, for Thais will have 15 points of damage easily next turn. So putting Oskaka to 1, and 1 is the exact point of health you want to have mage on. You just ping after that, get the icebook done, and then if there's another icebook, you ping again. So in course of 4 turns, right? Next you get into 1, then second turn ping, first icebook. Yeah, in course of 4 turns you actually win.
Sure, but you know, there's always something that, you know, in the freeze mage mirror messes up your counting by quite a bit. You gotta be a bit careful. Also, if you use your burn right now, what if your opponent just drops like an Emperor or like an Alexstrasza? You do need to save some removal for those creatures.
And Oskaka decides to save the Alexstrasza for a defensive opportunity later on in this game.
Right. This is so dangerous. Anti-Killbot will save him here. But he still doesn't have an Ice Block on.
No, still no Ice Block.
He has to either Arcane Intellect into an Ice Block or play the Healbot right now.
That's right. 13 damage means that 2 Fireballs and a Ping is enough to kill Thais. Well, Thais only knows that Oskar has 1 Fireball, so he might be a bit greedy here, but I mean, the chances are pretty against him.
Yeah, Arcane Intellect, likely to be the first thing he plays this turn.
Arcane Intellect, see what you get, and if you don't get Ice Block, just Healbot.
And of course, Thais is in a spot where his stress is compounded by the fact that if he loses this game, he's out.
Yeah. That might be his last stand. There is an ice block for him.
Okay.
But the anti-Killbot seems a little bit stronger here. Getting that minion on the board as well.
And he's still continuing with the plan to deal damage. And get
Frostbolt from Thais. He knows that putting his opponent down to 13 HP this turn would allow him to proc the ice block with 2 fireballs and a ping.
But it's a very interesting situation where Oskaka could actually choose to Alexstrasza, because after the anti-Killbot is played, Alexstrasza becomes that much better. You know that setting health to the 15 is not going to get healed anymore. And then, of course, you can, you know, just pop the ice block next turn. You always have to be careful about your own block getting popped.
Yeah, the thing about the extras is that you see Thais putting you down on 13. This means that double fireball and a ping is going to put you on one and pop your ice block as well. And you absolutely don't want to see that. And if you see that, you need Alexstrasza to come back to 15.
I actually think it's completely fine to see that, because then you and Alexstrasza all the way from there. After seeing all those burn spells, if he was to use the Alexstrasza right now, there could still be the potential Fireball Frostbolt in Thais' hand, which would allow him to proc the ice block anyway. So he's deciding to not use it just yet. And yeah. We can see that Thais actually has that combination of cards in his hand.
That's a really good call from Oskaka, just using Alexstrasza to gain some extra health.
Okay, both players have Alexstrasza.
This Alexstrasza is so useless to Thais now.
Don't underestimate just yet, because if Oskaka does go aggressive,
yeah,
you can have the answer to it. But because both players know they have an Alexstrasza, they're going to be very, very careful with the burn. So, for example, if Thais just goes all out and just spends two fireballs, use the ping, and then Oskaka follows up with Alexstrasza, Thais doesn't have any more reach.
I feel like this match, the previous game that we've seen going into Fatigue, and then Freeze Mage Mirror, is the embodiment of the European meta game. Most of the European players, they favor control. So,
Alright, well, Thais is changing up his game plan. He's going to try to Fatigue Oskaka.
Yeah, playing the Acolyte might prove to be Oskaka's downfall. He's going to lose a card. Frost Nova doesn't really matter. But if we have you know, a card count here, Oskaka might be closer to Fatigue than Thais is. And we know that Fatigue actually pierces through Ice Block, which is quite interesting.
Yeah.
Might change the dynamic.
If you go down. And this Healbot is also so useless here.
Right. So once again, this is the best use of Flamestrike.
Yeah.
Killing an anti-Healbot in this matchup.
And down it goes. Oskaka choosing not to play the Lothar in this situation. He does not want to draw that extra card.
Well, you have to think about the Fatigue at this point.
Oh yeah, now is the turn where it matters, because both players are kind of in a stalemate. They both have Alexstrasza, they don't want to use it. I mean, they do want to use it, but only when your opponent pulls the trigger, but they don't want to pull the trigger themselves, so...
And double Antonidas was used already, so they don't have that extra burst in their deck.
Exactly, no more resources are going to gain outside of their decks right now. So like you said, Nimsh, it's going to come down to Fatigue.
Yeah,
looks
this is
like
interesting.
It. And Thais seems to have the upper hand right now in this situation. Still at 20 HP while Oskaka is down to 13.
Oh man, this is just so funny. He's sitting on those fireballs. He can get him to one, pop the ice book, but he doesn't want to do it. He can't do it. Because then Alexstrasza will just heal him up to 15. There's no more burst. So now you have to use those small minions, but he doesn't even have the minions. Like, he can't play Acolyte of Fame.
No. You don't want to play it. I mean, you can, but you just, you know, kind of kill yourself.
Yeah, that seems like a bad strategy in this situation.
Seems like a bad strategy in any situation if you just to kill yourself.
Yeah, but I mean the Acolyte. But yeah, that also.
Yeah. All right, so for Oskaka, it seems like Oskaka might be in a... Well, it's a really similar situation. You can't really play Loot Hoarder because it will only give your opponent one card.
Right, so a fireball is going to be played here, and just going to use the hero power every turn.
Yeah, so we are going to see a lot of hero power being used.
Yep, Emperor finally comes in hand. That is the last threat, besides Alexstrasza.
Yeah, good card for Thais right now. That's going to force Oskaka probably to use one of the last remaining fireball on it, because he doesn't have an AoE to remove.
Never mind, Blizzard comes in the hand. Wow.
He's going to go aggressive here. Double Frostbolt and
this seems like it's the turn for Oskaka to go and pop the ice block here.
Oh,
he's going to establish the Doomsayer to actually prevent the Alexstrasza coming down. That is really, really cool. But...
Wow, such a great setup.
But,
Thais can
actually kill the Doomsayer.
That is correct. Because of the discounts on those cards, Thais can play the Frostbolt in addition to the Alexstrasza.
Yeah, usually you can't do that. Usually either clear the Doomsayer or you play the Alexstrasza. But here, no, that's pretty good for Thais.
Yeah, absolutely. So do you guys think Alexstrasza yourself is Thais and then going for the...
Oh yeah, I mean...
The Frostbolt is the...
You
seems
definitely.
Like the only play in this situation. I don't really see anything else. Could there be something else?
you fish for an ice block, paying your accolade, but you don't want any more card draws. So.
You can't go for. Oh, can you go maybe for popping the ice block? Is there any way?
I mean, you're at one health, so you have to solve that problem first.
Set up your own ice. Can you set? Oh, he doesn't have the second ice.
Yeah, exactly. So. Taj does exactly that.
Here we go. There is that Alex Straza coming from Thais.
And Emperor will have another tick. That's also important.
Not too relevant right now, as half of Taj's cards don't want to get played anyways. But whoa.
He's actually
sacrificing his board. Him. Okay. It's very interesting. And Oskaga has one more card left, which means that Taj only needs to deal 9 damage. And he's going to win the game, because once fatigue damage pierces through ice block.
That is true.
That's 9 turns of pinging.
Yep. And there you go. And Thais, on the other hand, he might be also close to fatigue. He is sitting on 2 cards.
So again, Thais is 1 card up over Oskaka, which means like he will take the damage later.
That's right.
And that's really important. This only shows excellence in the fatigue matches on the Thais' side. Is that ice block?
It's not really gonna matter too much because Oskaga does not have to burn anyways. I mean, we'll just go ahead and play it.
Yeah, why not?
Well, he can't really unload the damage. He can ping face, right? But you want to force Dalek Straza to play it.
Well, do you really want to ping the face here? I mean, you want to fireball and frostbolt the next turn so that you reduce your opponent's health exactly down to 1, and then, you know, the fatigue damage finishes off. So the ping actually kind of makes the math bad.
Yeah, I agree. I don't think he should necessarily ping here.
Right. So it's just going to be ice block pass, most likely?
Right.
And he is good going catch. To miss one damage there. No, that is not a mistake. He's done the math.
Oh, anti-killbot though. It's really interesting.
Yeah, that's pretty good for Skaka. That's a lot of health gain. So this game is far from over.
Yeah, because Thais is going to draw his fatigue as well. This Ice Bearer is going to come into play though. The only damage Oskaka can do is through minion combat.
Yeah, and with one Ice Barrier up and the second one in Thais' hand, it looks like he is going to most likely be able to win this game.
Right, and also a Cone of Cold, right?
Yeah, that also doesn't hurt.
He lost one Ice Block already. Thais.
Thais did lose an ice block, but it really doesn't really matter right now.
It really doesn't matter because we are at fatigue. In any case, Oskaga, considering his options, if he does not play an Alex Straza or the heal. Oh.
Whoa! That is really clever. So now Thais can actually kill him.
This is incredible.
Because he can't play up to 8 damage.
Thais is confused.
I mean, there is a little bit of a light bulb that comes up when your opponent doesn't ping you with the hero power. So I guess I'll do it for you.
Yeah, absolutely. He's so nice at the word stage.
Oh, man.
This was brilliant.
That truly was amazing.
Oh no! Look at it's like Thais. Oh, my plan got foiled.
You lose a turn, right? Like what you can you do?
Oh, he's looking like he's really in pain right now. He knows that he almost had the game in the bag. He still might.
That was so heads up.
Wow.
Oskaka.
Yeah, Oskaka not going to go for any kind of minion combat here. He's going to just try to out-heal the damage in Thais' hand and maybe win that fatigue war.
That's right. Oskaka does have effectively 14 health. Heal. Hopefully, he can get the full value off of Alex Straza. And of course, another 8 from anti-killbot. Oh, and now Thais is going to do a preemptive Doomsayer.
Well, Skaka doesn't have the burst to win here, but still, it really messed up the plan that Thais had.
That's true, but now it's interesting because Oskaka is going to take 2 damage, so Thais only needs to deal 6. So Oskaka can't just go with the strategy of paying himself again. It's not going to work this time.
Yeah, it's certainly not going to work, so he will be forced to play either the Healbot or the Alex Straza this turn.
Oh, and if he actually plays the Alex Straza, Thais deals 13 damage. So 13 damage is easy. 2 fireballs and a ping, and that's 13. So
that is true. So he has to play precisely the Healbot in order to survive.
Or he can play the Alex Straza and ping himself, right?
That would also...
Oh, no, it doesn't work. No, it doesn't work.
No, it actually wouldn't work.
Okay, wow, that's...
Thais is counting damage. Look at Thais.
Wait, no. Healbot doesn't really work either, because double fireballs and the Frostbolt is 15 damage.
It's true, so that
comes
should
out as
be
well.
Checkmate for right now.
Yeah, I don't really see an out here.
That ping was so smart, but it seems like Thais has it with the fatigue damage.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, Oskaga, of course, going through all the options here. Man, that pinkeye was really, really impressive. But right now it seems that he's backed into corner. And
the rope is running. What is Skaka gonna do? Can he play anything? He's going for the heal bot.
Yep, going for that 16. But unfortunately, Tice has the Frostbolt to deal the remaining damage.
Wow. Taking some fatigue damage. But
yep, and it seems like Oskar pulled the trigger a bit too early. And Tice is going to weather the storm and go to game five.
That game was so good. Wow. So good. And Tice is tying the series. Two fatigue wins.
So relieved right now.
How crazy is this series?
That was amazing. With all that, with that ping play, it was such a cool play from Ostgaga, but not enough in this situation.
And suddenly, Tice is coming to the last game at the best of five, winning two games in a row. How tired you have to be, and how exhausted mentally as Ostgaga, just losing two games.
Yeah, I mean, both players are pretty much, you know, using all their mental energy, thinking of all the plays. So impressive. So impressive about these past four games, and it's all going to come down to this. It's one final match, a single elimination, one winner goes through to the grand finals, and one not winner is going to have to leave here feeling a little bit empty-handed. But still, you know, you got this far, you're better than like a lot of people in the world, so you shouldn't feel too bad. But of course, players have to focus on this match.
Absolutely. And Savitz, what was your favorite moment during that? That whole game made
it had to be that ping from Ostgaga. I did not see that, and it was absolutely amazing. Now, Tice has won two games in a row, and for the game five of this series, he will have to now play his priest against the mage, and that might be a difficult task. It is certainly the most difficult one for him to win, and he needs to find ways to maybe like counterplay things like Doomsayer, Frost Nova that can be very problematic for a priest.
So what is the best strategy? Like, we identify it really as a bad matchup for Tice. Priest will have a hard time. You can counterplay the Doomsayer, Frost Nova, but what are you really looking for as a priest player?
A strong curve early on. Just hope to try to mulligan aggressively, try to get that 1, 2, 3, 4. And if possible, try to always think, what if my opponent goes for the Doomsayer, Frost Nova? What do I do then?
All right, and Amaz, from the freeze player perspective, you just go with your standard plan, or is there anything specific you can use?
Yeah, I mean, there is a good plan. You just need to remember that after you Alistraza your opponent's hero, that you have enough burn to finish them off. You can always just heal themselves and then get out of your range. So it's very important to wait till you have all the combo pieces ready to go and then just burn them all in two turns.
All right, we have an amazing audience. You guys can see the tavern is really busy. And Tice is thinking what he has to do. He knows it's a tough matchup. He knows this is the final stand. If he wins this, he advances to the final. But if he loses, then, well, he gets $15,000. But his road is actually ending here. Mm-hmm.
There's so much on the line in this last one. That priest has carried Tice this far in the tournament. But will it get him to the finals? We'll just have to see.
Yeah, that's right. Now that you mention it, his priest was actually undefeated throughout the top 16. So this is the match to win.
That's absolutely pretty impressive. The guys that are being here, Lothar as well, watching Tice, his teammate, his prodigy, and a cosplay. This is BlizzCon, guys. This is the world stage, Hearthstone World Championship.
Oh man, it's actually very detailed. Very impressive.
Yeah, that's really good cosplay.
Yeah, he's
All right, so Savitz, who do you think is gonna take it? Heart, like, just use your heart, not your mind.
Well, I've been saying it that I think that Tice is one of the favorites to win the entire tournament, but I have to give the edge to Ostgaga here. It's a good matchup for him, and he's a masterful player with the freeze mage. So I would predict Ostgaga, but I guess we'll just have to see.
All right, and Amaz, who do you think is going to take it?
Man, Oskaka's plays has been just so impressive. And, you know, it would be a shame that if he doesn't make the grand finals. Really, really cool. And, of course, Tice, on the other hand, I've been a fan of him since the beginning. Since, like, when he played ATLC, he got the first place. So, yeah, both players deserve it, but only one can go through.
I will go with my heart. I think Tice is going to take it. He is the European champion. Okay. He deserves it. But before we go into the last game, we have a small video prepared for you guys.
I heard that I said some words from winning the European Championship might be more difficult than winning BlizzCon. These words are a bit out of context, to be honest, but the way I meant that was that winning the European regionals, it was like a really hard road. We had to get already online and really good European players. And yeah, at the end, winning here is it's going to be super difficult. Like, there are so many good players left, and I hope I can do it, but it's going to be hard, and I have to perform. I think the decks that I bring here to BlizzCon will be a surprise for a lot of people. I'm not going here to survive the group, so I really want to win the tournament, and that's why I'm just taking a lot of risk. And yeah, I'm pretty sure people didn't expect this lineup from me.
All right, guys, best of five. This final game is going to decide who is going to the final. This was so amazing, such a journey. Two fatigue matches. Thais barely making it, winning versus Kaka. And now with his priest, the trusty priest, he's gonna face the Freeze Mage.
Yeah, two of Europe's finest going at it here. What a worthy game five. I'm really happy that this series went all the way up to five games.
Yeah, both players are excellent. And is there anything we don't know about them, Amaz?
I think we know a lot about them already throughout this journey, from the top 16. I even before the top 16, they had to like play a lot of ladder. And I know that Oskaga plays a lot of ladder. You know, he finishes top 100 in like nearly every single one of them. And just been racking up those points, you know, getting to the stage. It all comes down to this.
And yeah. Here we go. Thais from Netherlands going up against Oskaga from Sweden. It's going to be Priest from Thais going up against Oskaga's Freeze Mage.
All right, so we mostly said what they are looking for. Thais is looking to pressure, to play around those Doomsayers, deal enough damage, and he will hope that Oskaga will not get the clears and will stumble on his jaws. On the other hand, Oskaga wants to get all the combo pieces, Alexstrasza, and finish the game really fast.
Yep, and of course, both players are trying to look for the early games. These hands don't really seem like they can do the trick, so they might just pull back some of them, maybe get the you know, early pressure with the Valence chosen. Thais is playing second. And for Skaka, of course, the Mad Scientist, Acolyte Pain, those are always really, really strong cards. You don't want to get them stolen by Cabal Shadow Priest a bit later on.
How important is it to keep the dragon in his hand?
Well, you know, there is a lot of things that can activate off having a dragon in your hand, and Azure is one of those cards that do cycle for another card. So Thais does feel that this game could go long enough that maybe that will become useful.
Yep, he doesn't find the small dragon for turn one, but he does find Zombie Chow. So that is certainly something that he likes seeing.
I mean, Zombie Chow really can only be played in for early turns. If you play it later, the Freeze Mage can actually heal from it, and, you know, health swings from a Freeze Mage is very, very deadly.
Wow, that's an interesting hand from Oskaga. Those two secrets, not so good. But he also has a Mad Scientist and Dark and Intellect. Doomsayer also very valuable, so it's not too bad.
Yeah. Shrinkmeister is pretty cool. This means that Thais has a good curve with the Shrinkmeister, Dark Cultist, and Twilight Guardian into Azurdrake, into Coin Dr. Boom.
Right.
That's exactly what you wanted, right?
That is one of the better curves that a priest can hope for, especially against a Freeze Mage. Yeah, Freeze Mage, once again, is going to draw the cards. You know, priest plays really slow. I can take my time. But Thais just going to start racking the pressure up.
Yeah, we were talking about before this game started how important it is for Thais to curve out 1, 2, 3, 4, and he has it here. That is exactly what he was hoping for. But again, that Doomsayer Frost Nova, there's no way for him to counter it for now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but there's no Frost Nova for Oskaga. What Oskaga got is all the secrets, because he has double Ice Block, and one Ice Barrier was already used. He has second one in hand. Mad Scientist not giving him any value.
There's no secret left in Oskaga's deck for that Mad Scientist anymore. Yep, a little bit unfortunate for him, but he still has a fairly decent situation here, as long as he finds the AoE that he needs.
Yeah, the thing is, like, Priest doesn't have Burst. So even if Thais gets really far ahead, gets Oskaga pretty low, if Oskaga is able to take the grasp control of the game right there, clear the board, right, he might be in a good spot to win anyway.
But even though that Priest doesn't have the Burst, their advantage comes from the minion health. You see that we have Twilight Guardian at 6 health. Dark Cultist is going to give another 3 health when it dies. So it's... Priest minions are pretty sticky, so they're gonna actually do their damage most leap with the minions instead of spells.
Yeah, yeah, that's a fair point, Amaz.
Skaka puts down the second mad scientist and the ice barrier to slow Thais down at least a little bit.
Yep. And it's an interesting situation here for Thais. He might choose to actually sacrifice one of his minions or even not play a minion so that Dr. Boom does get the two Boom Bots out. You have to think a little bit ahead because anytime you have a big board against a freeze mage and they freeze your board, they limit your options quite a bit.
What would you expect being Thais from Oskaka next turn? Do you expect Blizzard or maybe the Frost Nova, Doomsayer? Something to, as a segue to the Flamestrike as well.
Yeah, you always have to be careful about the Frost Nova Doomsayer combo because right now you do not have an answer to it, and priests usually do not have an answer to it. Kabal Shadow Priest does not work. So, yeah, you just have to be careful not to overcommit.
Yeah, there's a lot of things that Thais has to worry about here, but there's nothing that he can really do about it except for just hope for the best and play his strongest minion. He does have a lot of gas so in his hand, so if he's board got clear, he could easily establish a new one.
Yeah, the Dr. Boom is super powerful. Black Ink Raptor looks alright as well, even though he doesn't have a dragon for now. There's a lot of dragons in his deck, so that's extra free damage that can be used at some point.
And Oskaga does not find a Blizzard or a Frost Nova.
Wow, what a board to be facing down as a Freeze Mage. You do not expect this board from a Priest player ever. Well, sometimes if they curve out really, really well. And this is one of those cases. There's 15 damage on the board, and effectively, you only have two turns left. So Oskaga feels a little bit too pressured here. Just gonna play an Emperor with only 5 cards in his hand in the, you know, effectively just try and stabilize the board.
There's a Valence chosen for Thais. That, with that 6 mana, he could go for Shadow of Death and play the Valence chosen for some additional pressure.
Yeah, that seems really good. Just dealing with the Torison and putting even more damage on Oskaka. Even though Zombie Chow is eventually gonna heal Oskaka if it dies. And it's gonna supposed to die next turn.
And Thais knows that its next turn from Oskaka is likely to be the Flame Strike, so the Valence chosen would also allow him to buff one of his minion, like another minion, out of the Flame Strike range. It seems like he was hovering over the Nocturne Cleric though, so he might be wanting to get the draw instead.
Mm-hmm. More answers is always pretty good against the Freeze Mage, especially those Holy Novas. After a perhaps Alexstrasza, you want that extra heal back. And it seems like...
Yeah, he's going to keep the Shadow over Death here, but this means that the Flame Strike is going to be able to clear everything except for one minion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but still pretty good play from Thais, just recognizing that it's hard to deal with one big minion from the Mage's perspective, and that there is a problem. Froze Nova is a great pickup with this there.
That's right, and it's... We can see that Thais does not actually have an answer to deal with that. Black and Corruptors don't really work well against Doomsayer, and you know, we don't see anything like a Shadow of Pain or anything.
And there's also no dragon for those Corruptors right now in Thais's hand.
Oh yeah.
So Battle Cry would not activate.
This means Oskaka can even think about playing Loot Hoarder just to cycle it into another card.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Oskaka really low on cards now.
Wow, gonna draw that card immediately to dodge the Kabal Shadow Priest.
Yeah, that's a good play there. And the Doomsayer drops down. There's nothing to kill it.
Alright, Thais needs to find an answer, and that is not one of those. So his whole board is going to get wiped here, and he can't really even develop anything.
No, he can draw one card with the Nocturne Cleric, though. Maybe he could find a card to kill it. No, that's not going to do it. He has a lot of spell power, so the Holy Nova would be 4 damage, but still not enough.
And yeah. Wow, what a turnaround. Oskaka has stabilized. See if he can leverage this somehow.
That Frost Nova was so important. The Acolyte of Pain is great here. He will be able to draw more cards. This is exactly what he needed. He needs to replenish his hand, and then with more spells, he might actually stop Thais. But Thais had a really good opening. He got Oskaka quite low, and he still has a lot of cards in his hand.
Yeah, I would still say that Thais is ahead in this game just because Oskaka's hand is so small right now. He only has 5 cards. Yes, the Acolyte will draw an extra card, but it doesn't. It's not very threatening. If you Thais and you knew what was in Oskaka's hand, you would not be worried one bit.
And there is a dragon as well. This means that Black Knight Raptor can deal a 3 damage, deal with Acolyte of Pain.
Another Doomsayer being picked up by Oskaka. He needs something more.
Oh,
that's a good one.
Yeah, Arcane Intellect, getting some more cards, replenishing his hand.
All right. And yeah, the burn is starting to come into the hand. If Alexstrasza ever comes for Oskaka here, he could actually just pull the trigger and go all in here. Flametrick's gonna clear this board quite well, and once again, stall for more turns.
I'm just trying to count the damage here. So if he gets Alexstrasza next turn, he'll have 6 from Fireball, then Iceland's is 8, so that's 14, 17.
Oh,
wow. How much is that now?
That means this is plus 4, so it will be 21.
21, I believe. And with the ping 20, no, he can't afford to ping the throne.
Without the Emperor anymore on all those spells, the maximum damage a Freeze Mage can pull out of their hand is 21. We call that kind of like the blackjack rule.
Yeah.
Yeah. But of course, Emperor messes the math up. Taish doesn't know that. Taish knows that some cards are reduced by Emperor, but doesn't know quite which, so he's gonna be playing extra safe. Doesn't dodge the fact that Oskaka, if he draws Alexstrasza, the game might just be over.
Yeah, but he might need to use a Fireball here to deal with Dr. Boom.
Mm. Or do you? Do you just play, perhaps the Doomsayer and heal yourself for 7?
I think it's also possible that he would go for some kind of cycle on the Blood Mage. Yes.
Okay.
Seems, yeah, he's going for it. He wants to double his chances in finding that Alexstrasza.
There you go.
For the next turn.
Let's see how much the boombox hit. One.
That's so bad for Thais.
That is so good for Oskaka, though. Oh, wow. It's actually Ice Lance to Dr. Boom. And once again, Thais is faced again. Wow. Fail is chosen.
This time, Thais can deal with that. That's with the Blackwing Corruptor, Holy Nova, or Blackwing Corruptor, Valence Chosen. There's a lot of ways to do this. Mm-hmm. But also just Valence Chosen.
And Corruptor.
And, Corruptor, yeah, that's the most likely one because that gives him the most possible power on the board.
This is so good for Thais.
Yeah.
The second Doomsayer, we've seen a Flame Strike, so there is only Blizzard left.
That's right, and a very good position here. Oskaka draws a Blizzard, once again can stall the game out, but keeping the Holy Novas for Thais is actually so important. He can play Holy Nova into Hero Power, heal himself to 4 over 2 turns, that's 8 health. So that's a lot of health gain.
Oh, that's the second Fireball. So this means that the game can still end if there is an Alexstrasza draw from Oskaka. But at this point, it looks really good for Thais anyway, because there is not enough clears to deal with the board.
Well, now that you mentioned that, it's actually a very scary situation. If Thais does get Alexstrasza, he's probably going to be Holy Nova and then heal himself, right? That's 19. And 19 is exactly how much damage Oskaka has. So Thais needs to end this game before it gets to that point.
Yeah. Matters and the Icebook as well. So Oskaka still has some time to get that Alexstrasza. It all depends on that.
Yeah, and Thais could go for a Holy Nova to try heal up his own minions.
Oh.
But I believe Oskaka is only running one Flame Strike and it's already being played, so there are no board clears available for Oskaka.
And once again, it comes back to the matchup of Priest versus Mage, right? Where Mage has that store that combo for over 2 turns, Alexstrasza plus the burn. Sometimes it just might be too much for the Priest to deal with. They don't have access to armor or any overhealing, so that's the weakness of it.
Is Antonidas enough for Oskaka?
Well, Antonidas is definitely not as good as Alexstrasza because it makes the math really, really difficult. Yep. Another Frostbolt comes into hand.
That's so a lot better. Of damage, but not enough to win the game here.
Well, it's pretty interesting right now because the Frostbolt does make it so that Oskaka doesn't die next turn. He could also use it against the Dr. Broom because Holy Novas might prop block. He could also choose the Fireball and kill off the Dr. Broom that way. But then, of course, you don't get the Alexstrasza burst combo that you're looking for.
Unless he goes for the Frostbolt on the Dr. Boom, the Ice Block is getting popped. Those Holy Novas in Thais' hand are 3 damage each, but with only 9 on the board, that adds up to 15.
So he's still safe. It
would be one off from popping the Ice Block.
Yep, which means the Holy Novas are not going to be used. Oh, Cabal Shadow Priest is not really a good card right now.
How many draws still Oskaka has to win with Alexstrasza? Like, he needs to have Ice Block up when he draws it.
But he still has his Ice Block up right now in this exact moment.
Does.
So this is the turn for Alexstrasza, for Oskaka. And of course, Thais is going to cross his fingers and hope that this is not the case.
So this might be the last draw for him.
Very well possibly.
if he draws an Alexstrasza after that, he will not be able to play Iceblock and Alexstrasza in the same.
Yeah, he'll have to go with another strategy, perhaps clearing the board and then Alexstrasza hitting the face. But Shadow War Death is going to make short work of it.
It's so amazing that Thais is so close to winning this game.
Very important draw here for Skaka. He gets Alexstrasza!
Oh my god!
Wow!
This is incredible!
That's exactly the card you're looking for. Now Thais is going to be reduced down to 15 health. And four extra healing is the maximum thing you can do. And of course, Osaka has the 19 damage. Can Thais actually get away
with
this?
With the spell damage, is that plus six?
But the spell damage, the spell power only buffs the damage part of the Holy Nova. It will still heal for only two damage.
Which is 19, which is exactly what Osaka has in his hand.
Wow. He has the coin, but it's not enough to squeeze out the hero power.
Yeah, Holy Nova costs a little bit too much. Playing both would be 12 mana, and that top deck, right?
That was the last moment. That was the only moment he needed. He needed that extra Zac. Without drawing it, the game was in Thais's hand.
Yeah, pretty much.
It was the very last.
It would have
been
really
moment.
Difficult.
So Thais goes through the motions.
Yep.
Gets the ice block.
Yeah, of course you want to use the hero power because you can Holy Nova next turn and hero power to get even more healing. But unfortunately for him, the Emperor reducing the Ice Lance is just enough to finish the game. Osaka is going to the Grand Finals and he's going to have a chance at the World Championship.
He just needs to go for the motions.
Yep.
Double Fireball is 12, Frostball is 15.
Yeah, gotta not tremble now with your fingers. He's gonna just drag the four spells directly to Thais's opponent, and that's the game.
Yeah, that is game. And with that Frostbolt and Ice Lance, it is apparent that Osaka takes it, and he goes to the finals of the World Championship.
I still can't believe it.
What a match.
It looks so bad for him. He was hoping to get the Alexstrasza, not getting it. Then on the last moment, he actually gets it. And has exactly the 19 damage that he needed to lethal there.
I can't believe how close Thais was with this priest deck. It was such a bad matchup, but he was almost there.
Yeah.
One card away.
And not to mention that the whole series was just such... It's so intense, right? We got the Rogue doing Osaka's Rogue stuff, and then we have the self-ping. There was just so many different situations where the game could have panned out differently, if not for these two world-class players that are playing. But Osaka is going to take it today, and his play was so impressive. He definitely deserves a spot in the finals, and he's going to face against the winner of Hot Form and Kuno. That's going to be happening after this.
Absolutely. Osaka is our first finalist. Savitz, do you have anything to say about this amazing match?
I was predicting that we are going to see a good game, but that was an understatement. That was an amazing match. It was just mind-blowing. That's Hearthstone at its best.
All right, I absolutely agree. Guys, Rachel is ready with our winner on the stage. Let's hear his thoughts.
Thanks so much, Nimsh. I'm here with Osaka, and you know what? That was incredible, especially that final draw, Alexstrasza for the win. How did you feel when you saw that face?
I mean, it was like a 1-5 or 1-6, so at that point, it was just, I thought it was almost over. It was the only card I could draw at that point. But I mean, this series overall was just the most intense series I've ever played, and so many close situations. I almost managed to like throw it away because I felt like in game three, I didn't play super well. I was a little bit inexperienced in that matchup. But for the rest of the series, I think I played pretty well, so I'm really happy that I made it to the finals.
Congratulations. Osaka's moving on to the finals, taking out Thais. And you talked about hard choices, especially in game two. We saw you make an exceptionally hard choice. You took out your own Bludgemage Thalanos to play Lotheb. What do you have to calculate when you're making these extremely hard choices in these very high stakes matches?
For me, it's just a lot about like looking at what your opponent has in his hand and just experience with the matchup, just playing it over and over again on ladder. And obviously, Lotheb is really good against Freeze Mage. I saw that he was setting up the Flame Strike, so it was a very logical move.
Now, you and Thais are two of the most accomplished players on the Hearthstone World Championship stage this weekend. You both have a number of accolades that you've earned throughout the years. Do you feel better having Thais behind you as an opponent, or do you still feel like the next matchup is going to be your most difficult matchup?
I feel like this match was almost worthy of like being a grand final, so it was an insanely close match. But of course, the other two semifinals are also really strong, so I'm looking forward to the finals, of course.
We're looking forward to the finals as well. Please give one more round of applause. Our first finalist, Osaka. Our next semifinal match between Kuno and Hotform is coming up soon. In the meantime, here is our Windows 10 Game DVR replay.